alive on NBC Sports. The network of the 1984 World Series is proud to present the Major League Baseball Game of the Week. Today in the National League West, it's Dale Murphy and his first place Atlanta Braves. They're in Los Angeles to play the Dodgers. Los Angeles finally cooled off the Braves last night. While some of you will be seeing an American League East battle, those first place Tigers are in Baltimore. Detroit picked up a game on both the Orioles and Blue Jays last night. But first up, it's Major League Baseball, an inside look at baseball and a preview of today's game. Brought to you by Light Beer from Miller, an official beer sponsor of Major League Baseball. And by Ace. Ace is the place with the helpful hardware man. Hi again, everyone. Welcome to the Game of the Week. Len Berman in New York. Coming up in a few minutes from cool Los Angeles, the Dodgers and Braves, only 80 degrees there. While some of you will see the Tigers and Orioles in Baltimore, 116 degrees on the field for that one. Coming up on our pregame report, I'll visit the number one draft pick in America, and we will have a successful proposal. But first up, let's go to our announcers for today's games. Let's start in Los Angeles with Vin and Joe.
Thank you, Len. Well, Joe, it's the third game of a four-game series, and once again, the National League West is starting to look wild again.
Well, you look at the standings and you wonder. The Atlanta Braves are now in first place. Horner gets hurt. You figure the bottom's going to drop out, and they continue to win. They got beat last night, true. The Dodgers, they look like maybe left over from MASH with all their injuries. They're battling. San Diego is there. It is wild.
And, of course, San Diego might be the dark horse right now. It's taken them a while to get all the pieces to fit, but suddenly they find themselves only a half a game out.
They do, and you know, as you, even as you look at the Phillies, I just wonder if the DL is going to, the disabled list is going to play a bigger part this year than ever. Schmidt was out, Matusek was out, they win a doubleheader. I just wonder, is the bench going to be the big factor this year for real?
It seems to me that in the major leagues so far this year, there have been something like 95 players on the disabled list, so the DL might be the magical phrase of all. And with that, let's go to Baltimore.
All right, thanks, Joe. Thanks, Ben, with me. The catcher of the Orioles, Rick Dempsey, and one of the best hitters in the game today, Eddie Murray. Rick, take it.
I got it. I was asking Eddie a little bit earlier about some problems that I go through as a hitter. I mean, I seem to be pulling off the ball quite a bit, and I really can't make myself stay in. What do you think is my problem, Ed? You told me a second ago.
Well, I think the basic problem is that you might be popping up out of your original batting stance. In other words, moving your head from here to here before you go out after the ball, approach the ball, and that could cause you sometimes to probably only see half of a baseball and, you know, cause you to hit, I think, a lot of ground balls.
Yeah, I know last night against Doug Bear, I know he was throwing me the slider, and that's exactly what I was doing. I went out after the ball, and right when I planted my front foot and started my swing, then my head came up and I came off the ball and made it look really bad. So I was trying to find out from you how I could correct that.
Well, basically, for pulling off the ball, what you want to try and do is hit the ball up the middle. If you point your front shoulder, I think, at the pitcher and stride directly at him, I think you would, you know, you have a little more success that way.
Oh, well, thanks, Ed. I hope it works today. Now back to New York and Len Berman.
Okay, thank you, Rick. I never got a throw before from a World Series Most Valuable Player, Rick Dempsey in Baltimore. Eddie Murray, you will see in our top highlights of the week coming up, his confrontation this past week with Peter Ladd of the Brewers. But coming up next on our pregame report, we'll have the Kid Abner, who'll be playing for Doubleday. We'll be right back, everybody.
I like things that last. This old car runs like a watch. My house is over 96 years old. Been married to Enid 23 years. Here's the first new thing I've bought in 8 years.
Nine.
It's a Honda lawnmower. Overhead valve design. Real durable. I bought it because it'll last.
Like my dog, 12 years old. Known Fred forever. This shirt belonged to my dad.
The Honda lawnmower. It could be the last lawnmower you ever buy.
As a relief pitcher, everybody thought I had it easy. See Pat here? He'd pitch his heart out for 8 innings or so, and then
Sparky could come in, toss 3 or 4 pitches, and walk away with a win.
But I had to
train just like the rest of us.
Yeah, well, I still like to keep in shape, and I drink
light beer from Miller.
See, light's less filling, and light really
tastes great.
Will you just let me finish?
Why? You never let me finish.
Light beer from Miller. Everything you always wanted in a beer, and less.
Let me finish that for you, Sparky.
Hose.
Hose?
Hose.
All
our 80-foot Ace hose is a June Best Buy. Double reinforced so it's tough and flexible. Best Buy priced at $9.88.
Sprinkler.
Sprinkler? The Nelson Turbo Heart Sprinkler is powerful, durable, and it prevents puddling.
Puddling?
Sure. Its special design distributes water evenly, so no puddles. And it's a Best Buy at $3.88.
Ace.
Ace?
Ace is the place with the helpful hardware woman.
And man.
Time now for the top highlights of the week. We've got brushbacks, we've got home runs, and other stuff with a musical backdrop, appropriately enough, from Thriller. Here goes. It was a week for breaking around Major League Baseball. In St. Louis, Joaquin Andujar of the Cardinals nearly nailed Ozzie Virgil of the Phillies. Here comes Ozzie trying to break Joaquin. Virgil got ejected, Andujar got heaved an inning later. Eddie Murray of the Orioles got in on the chin music as well. Peter Ladd pitching for the Milwaukee Brewers. He nearly nails Eddie. Murray takes offense. Ladd says, come on if you got something to say. Eddie declines the invitation. So they play on. And the very next pitch, Murray says, take that. Things are starting to heat up. The biggest home run of the week, Dave Bergman of the Tigers. He broke up a 3-3 tie with this three-run 10th-inning homer. The Blue Jays and Tigers broke even in a four-game series. Some great moves around the bases this week. Inside the park homers, George Bell of Toronto, a mammoth shot in Detroit. Bell broke it all the way around, as did Don Baylor of the Yankees and Steve Henderson of the Mariners. Three inside the park homers. And here's a break. Bill Buckner hits it. Catcher Butch Weininger says, where'd it go? There it is. Base hit. Bad news and good news. The Braves lost Bob Horner when he broke his wrist again on this play. Despite the major loss, the Braves ripped off 9 straight wins on the road. But the biggest break of the week for the Mets. They lost the game in Pittsburgh on the sacrifice fly. But the Mets appealed that Lee Mazzilli left third base too soon. The umpires agreed, so no winning run. The Pirates wound up losing in the 13th instead. Now there's a break. And this week, a 17-year-old by the name of Sean Abner was drafted number one by the Mets. The Mets are owned by Nelson Doubleday. They signed them yesterday, so Abner and Doubleday are now a team. But being drafted number one and becoming a number one baseball player are often two different things.
Hello, Cleveland?
Yes.
Okay.
We've got a problem with that.
The draft began in 1965. The number one pick in that number one draft, Rick Monday by the A's. Not bad. Tom Seaver was drafted in the 24th round, a tip-off of things to come. He was drafted by the Dodgers but didn't sign. The next year, in 66, the number two pick was Reggie Jackson. But the Mets went first and took Steve Chilcott. He never played in the majors. 18 years later...
First pick, New York Mets.
The Mets select Abner. First name is Sean.
Hello? Okay, thank you. Bye-bye. Just came over 5 with the Mets.
Mets alive!
Welcome to Mechanicsburg High School in Mechanicsburg, Pennsylvania. The Mets had the number one pick again this year, and they came here. They drafted a sensational 17-year-old hitter by the name of Sean Abner. The odds are pretty good he'll make it to the major leagues. But unlike the number one picks in basketball and football, there's no guarantee he'll be a big success.
Baseball's like the jungle of sports because you have to work for everything that you want. You can't just be picked like Bob Horner, I think, is one exception that was taken right up. But most of the high school players, after put into the rookie league or instructional league, and they have to work and strive for what they want to do. It's up to them.
His batting average this year approached 600. A terrific center fielder. His three previous years, he never batted under 400. And in football, here he is returning a kickoff for a touchdown. The University of Georgia was hoping he'd be their quarterback. But Sean wants baseball, and the Mets want Sean to be their shortstop.
They liked the way I perform, the way I handle myself with the pressure and everything, and they said that they were looking for a young person in their organization that could do the job for them.
He can run, he can throw, he can catch the ball. He hits the ball, and he hits it with power. And the tough thing with these young people is try to project what they're going to be like in 3 or 4 years. What type of ball player would he be?
How about switching from outfield to shortstop? Does that make you a bit unsettled?
No, I want to play where whatever position is going to make me move up the fastest, and they feel that I'll move up fast as an outfielder, but they think I can move up even faster as a shortstop.
What do you hope your schedule will be now over the next couple of years? What do you project for yourself?
I'd like to make it within 2, 2.5, 3 years. I figure that's what it might take me, and hopefully it'll come down to the least amount of time that I mature and get on top of my game.
And he hopes that 84 is like 78 when Bob Horner was number one, Lloyd Mosby number two, and Hubie Brooks number three. He prays it's not at all like 71. That's the year Danny Goodwin, Jay Franklin, and Tom Bianco were 1, 2, 3, and folks like Mike Schmidt, George Brett, Mike Flanagan, and Jim Rice weren't. It was also the year future Met Keith Hernandez went in the 42nd round. Compare that with that first Mets pick in 66.
Hopefully, Sean Abner won't be put in a Steve Chilcott situation, but hopefully I can make it.
Well, Sean, hopefully the next interview we do will be a couple of years from now. Pre-game show, the game of the week. You'll be a major leaguer and all set to go. That'll be fun.
Hopefully that'll be the case.
All right, great. Nice talking with you.
You too.
And the odds are that interview will take place in a couple of years. Of all the number one picks, all except Chilcott and the most recent picks who haven't had time, all of them have made it to the majors. We'll be right back.
All the way. Support the home team all the way.
Now you can give Olympic gold and silver, because for the first time, the U.S. Treasury is issuing Olympic commemorative coins. They're beautiful gifts or keepsakes, and the precious metal you buy could help win Olympic medals.
Be part of the dream today. Support the home team all the way home.
At many banks, coin dealers, fine stores, savings and loans, and post offices.
To everyone who bought a grass trimmer that may have cost a little less than a weed eater trimmer and did a lot less, it was supposed to last as long as a weed eater trimmer would, but couldn't. This simple message. Weed eater trimmers have trimmed and edged more lawns than any other trimmer in America. Now there must be a reason.
I should have bought a weed eater trimmer.
If it doesn't say weed eater, it's just another trimmer.
Alex Ramos, the Bronx Bomber. John Collins, the big southpaw from the Windy City. Two middleweight contenders at the crossroads. On NBC Sports World, there is a world of difference.
Checking the scoreboard now, games underway. Wild one in Cleveland. Indians got six in the bottom of the first. They now lead Seattle 8-6 as they play the top of the fourth. At Fenway, Milwaukee got two in the top of the second. Red Sox just countered with two in the bottom, tied 2-2 as they play the third. Here's the Brewers two. This is Bobby Clark. Two-run shot off Bobby Ojeda over the monster, top of the second at Fenway. As I said, the Red Sox have just tied it 2-2 in the third. Finally, you've heard of the seventh-inning stretch. Here now the fifth-inning hitch. It involves White Sox first base coach Davey Nelson. Happened the other night at Comiskey Park in Chicago.
There's Davey lower left, his girlfriend Kathy on the right. She has yet to see the scoreboard sign, which reads, "Kathy, will you marry me?" Now she sees it. Davey walks over towards her and hands her a diamond engagement ring. And in front of 25,000 fans, Kathy thankfully says, "Yes." So, there's a game to be played. Davey goes back to work. Kathy begins making some wedding plans.
They've got a kangaroo court in Chicago. Manager Tony La Russa fined Davey Nelson $10 for kissing on the field. And he told him that if we used the tape on our pregame report, it would be another 10 bucks. Davey Nelson told me the other day it was well worth it. And that'll do it for our pregame report. I'm Len Berman. Coming up, baseball action. Hope you enjoy the game, everybody.
Tonight, it's no joking. Arnold's smoking. But will Dad burn his butt? Then on Silver Spoons, Edward's in pain. And guess who gave it to him?
It's my fault.
That's right!
But will the cure be worse than the ailment?
You'll run the risk of people calling a scarbelly.
The prescription's laughs on Silver Spoons.
Be there tonight.
Pulse, pulse, baby bank pulse. Frost banks, baby bank pulse.
the bigger bank card, ready where you are. Frost Banks. Frost Banks, ready bank post. The bigger bank card, ready bank post. Ready where you are, everywhere you are. All over Texas, all over town. Ready bank post, the bigger bank card from Frost.
The Frost family of banks.
Ready bank post, the bigger bank card.
What a bummer. Another engine we can't mess up.
How could Mobil do this to me?
Yeah, improve their super unleaded gasoline.
It's really powerful.
Higher octane is so...
Knocking and pinging is becoming a lost art.
Yeah. I just hope nobody else finds out how good their new gasoline is. How could they find out?
Mobil could make a television commercial.
George McKenzie and the final score.
A Monday night in Georgia, the pitcher Al Downing, the team the Los Angeles Dodgers, and Henry Aaron keeps his date with destiny as he hits home run number 715 to become the greatest home run hitter in baseball history. Today, the Braves came in with 27-year-old Dale Murphy, the youngest to win back-to-back Most Valuable Player Award. And he indeed has a shot as he leads the league in home runs with being the MVP yet again in 1984. NBC Sports presents Major League Baseball Game of the Week. Today from Dodger Stadium, the Atlanta Braves versus the Los Angeles Dodgers. The Game of the Week is brought to you by Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? By Rust-Oleum, the paint for metal. When the elements come, be ready with tough, long-lasting Rust-Oleum. By Light Beer from Miller, an official beer sponsor of Major League Baseball. And by Mr. Goodwrench and General Motors Parts. Dodger Stadium, temperature in the high 70s, maybe 80 degrees. Better weather, I guess, than in the majority of the United States. Welcome to Los Angeles. Hi, everybody. I'm Vin Scully, along with Joe Garagiola. And Joe, two ball clubs battling for first place, and they both literally limped onto the field.
It looks like the trainer may be the most valuable player. We look at the disabled list, and you look at the Braves. Scalped Braves, I don't particularly like that word scalp for obvious reasons. That's a disabled list. Rick Camp, Terry Harper, Bob Horner, of course you've read so much about him, he's had a tough time. Terry Forster's been out, Donnie Moore has been out, and Claudel Washington, who was real hot, yet they're in first place.
Yes, they are in first place. Meanwhile, the Dodgers had problems of their own. They started by losing utility man Bob Baylor in spring training, then they lost Greg Brock, who's now back, Kenny Landreau, who has returned, Royce, who has missed four starts and is out for 15 days, Marshall, who missed 19 games, Bill Russell with a bad side, and Mike Socha with a bad knees. So the Dodgers led despite all that in the month of April and May, and despite their problems, suddenly the Braves are in first.
They are in first, and the one thing about it, though, if you know ahead of time, like the Dodgers and Braves, it's early, plenty of time to make it up.
Well, the DL used to mean dead last, but not anymore.
Not anymore.
We'll be right back and get the starting lineups right after this.
Arthur Ashe.
Yeah?
Is that your Ford Tempo?
Sure is.
Why a Tempo?
Well, as a coach, I know good form when I see it.
Good form?
Sure. Tempo's well designed. And it has good moves.
You like its front wheel drive?
Yeah, it's great when your opponent is wet roads or snow.
Well put.
I'm learning.
How about Tempos now outselling all the imports in America?
I know about foreign competition.
Arthur, is it true you have all your trophies in the back seat? Have you driven the best-built American cars? Have you driven a Ford lately?
You know, I lease so reliable here from AT&T. It's gone through the Griffith Family School of Hard Knocks and come through with flying colors. Of course, if I ever did have a problem, I just call AT&T toll-free or take it to one of their phone centers for exchange. Leasing smart for me. It's smart because no matter what happens, I can always relax.
AT&T Consumer Sales and Service.
A new design in radial tires is rolling your way from Goodyear. Say hello to Vector.
Well, howdy, Vector. I've never seen tread like that before.
Goodyear's new Vector has a unique tread.
Crisscross curve. What are they for?
Traction. All-season traction in snow and rain.
Just what we need around here, Vector.
Plus outstanding mileage down the road. Say hello to the new design in radial tires.
Hiya, Vector. I'm Norm Schechter.
Vector, the new radial design from Goodyear.
Bring your group to the game. Share the fun. It's for everyone. Now playing at a ballpark near you. Baseball Fever. Catch it.
The preceding message was furnished by Major League Baseball.
Hi, I'm Bob Gibson. Starting off for our ball club today is Rafael Ramirez, one of the better young shortstops in the league. Spray hitter, gets on base a lot, doesn't walk very often. Randy Johnson hitting second, replacing Bob Horner, at least temporarily. Hitting third is Gerald Perry. In our opinion, he'll be one of the better hitters in the National League in the years to come. Hitting fourth, Dale Murphy, two-time MVP. Everybody knows him. Hitting fifth is Chris Chambliss, first baseman, originally from the Yankees, great ball player. Hitting sixth is Glenn Hubbard. We like little Hubby. He's going to be probably one of the better second basemen in the history of baseball. Hitting next is Brad Commence, young ball player, just came up from the minor leagues. He's having some problems right now, but we think a lot of him. Hitting next is Bruce Benedict, one of the catchers of our ball club. He's been on the bench lately because of a trade we've made, but we think Benedict is going to probably be there when the season ends. And hitting ninth is Rick Mahler, one of the better hitting pitchers in the National League.
National Anthem played here at Dodger Stadium, and we had a touching moment or two behind home plate pregame ceremonies as the lovely Rachel Robinson, widow of the late and great Jackie Robinson, and leading the Jackie Robinson Foundation, and Rachel presenting two scholarships from the foundation to two high schoolers who will be now going to UCLA. And of course, back in New York, the New York Yankees and the New York Mets established scholarships for youngsters at St. John's University. The four umpires, it'll be Charlie Williams and Joe. Let's take a look at the way the Dodgers stack up defensively.
And there are some changes. Mike Marshall will be in the left field. Landro is in center field. R.J. Reynolds will be in right field. Guerrero is at third base. Dave Anderson will be the shortstop. Bob Baylor replaces Sachs at second base. Greg Brock is at first base. And Big Mike Socia behind the plate. And if we get a tag play at the plate, you're going to see some tremendous blocking because he does it better than anybody I've ever seen.
Yeah, he's not only a big man and puts up the big block, but he is a great help to Fernando for one other reason. He speaks a little bit of Spanish. The numbers for Fernando are not impressive, 5-6. You have to remember, in his first start of the year, he gave up 6 earned runs against the Cardinals. Since then, his ERA is less than 2, but the Dodgers don't score for him. In his 5 losses prior to that opening day defeat, the Dodgers have gotten him a grand total of 6 runs in 5 losses.
In fact, the one game he won, didn't he win it 1-0?
That's right, and he knocked in the run while striking out 15 to beat Steve Carlton.
It's a little tough to know you have to go out and pitch a shutout, and you might get a tie.
The interesting thing is the Dodgers and Braves get together. It is the third straight year where the Dodgers and Braves meet for the first time, as they did the other night on June the 7th. Now, on May the 1st, the Braves were trailing the Dodgers by 7. And one reason, of course, is the rebirth of Fernando after the opening day. But the Braves have made a move, and the Dodgers have staggered. And it's interesting that no other Western team outside of Atlanta has been over 500 since the 2nd of May.
Looking at that graph we just had of the strikeout pitches, you would say of the four that were up there, Valenzuela is the least as far as velocity is concerned. So it's mostly a screwball. I mean, names like Ryan and Soto, you know they've got the good hummer, but Valenzuela does it with that screwball, which I'm sure the Braves will see a lot of today.
Indeed, they should, and he's been pretty successful with them. Lifetime, he is 6-3. Here is Rafael Ramirez talking about successful. He takes a breaking ball strike. He has 6 hits in the 10 at-bats in this series, 3-for-5 Thursday and last night. And Ramirez has a shot to be the first Atlanta Braves shortstop to hit 300. He's batting 292.
That was the screwball, and with the center field shot, you can see Socha really giving a low target. Screwball up high, no good. You got to get it below the belt line.
So Rafael Ramirez followed by Randy Johnson and then Gerald Perry, and the strike two pitch, just missing ball one, 1-2. It's early going, and we would like to send along best wishes to National League umpire Satch Davison and all of his umpires here working this game, and all of his friends in baseball would send along their best wishes for a speedy recovery to Satch, who is home with his bride Lynn in Houston recuperating.
I wonder if he's chewing tobacco while he's at home recuperating. I never could understand how he could umpire behind the plate with that big chaw going.
And not swallow it.
And not swallow it.
1-2 to Rafael Ramirez. And Fernando, who gave his first interview in English the other day, so he's coming along in that direction. And a check on a fastball hit foul, and Ramirez just trying to protect the outside part of the plate. Got his bat on it. He had 185 hits last year.
I also thought he got a bad rap as far as his fielding. I think he's an aggressive fielder, and they talk about all the errors he makes. That's one of those things that I think if you watch a guy every day, you get a different feel for what he can do.
The 1-2 pitch is lined to left field. Marshall's going to have to play it on a bounce. So Ramirez opens up the ballgame with a line single to left.
Batting second.
Randy Johnson has replaced Horner, Horner being out with an injury. What kind of pressure does that present? Here's what he said.
Well, I don't feel a whole lot of pressure. I went through the same situation last year, and we took a lot of heat for not driving the runs into Bob does, but nobody's going to replace Bob as a hitter. I just hope that I can maybe play a little better defense and get on base and score a few runs. And hopefully the other guys will hit the home runs, and we won't miss them as much as we have in the past.
Well, the screwball misses to Randy, who's going to be 28 years old tomorrow, so we can send him an early happy birthday. He has a 9-game hitting streak, and he's hit close to 400 during that stretch to move his average well up over 300.
Johnson took a long time looking at the sign, like he may have missed it the first time.
Fernando has 2 moves. I guess one you'd call the commercial move, where he lulls the runner. He lets you read him until you think, oh, well, now I got him. And then he comes with the killer. Now, Ramirez has stolen 7 out of 9, so you're going to have a pretty good battle here.
Here is the catcher where you really watch the batter. Now watch him. He's really taking a long look at Max Bell, who's going through a series of signs. And he's going to just keep going and going even after Johnson's back in that batter's box. It's a good play here. 2 balls and no strikes. Fernando's probably going to come in with the screwball. He can go the opposite field.
And Rafael with a very short lead, and nevertheless, Fernando's after him. In talking about Ramirez, he has stolen 7, but he has been caught 9 times. Last year, the Braves had the poorest percentage of base stealing outside of Pittsburgh in the National League. The 2-0 pitch is high, so Fernando, who for whatever reason normally has all of his troubles in the first couple of innings, and he starts out with a single, and now he's behind 3-0. Another interesting thing about this homestand for the Dodgers, they have given up a run in the first inning in 7 of the 8 games in the homestand. That's a strike. Last night, They were roughed up immediately by Dale Murphy's two-run home run.
Well, I always felt, Ben, if you're going to run him 3-2, and I feel he would run him 3-2, you might as well run him 3-1. So this could be an early big pitch of the game. If he gets a strike, Socha's got a good chance of throwing Ramirez out because he's got a very short lead.
Very. And still, Fernando decides, okay, if you have a short lead, maybe that means you're easily intimidated, so I'll try to shorten you up some more.
If he does, he'll be in the coach's box.
3-1 to count. Ramirez goes, and it's fouled away. Fernando has picked three men off so far, and as far as running against him, there have been five stolen bases, but six runners have been caught. He's got a good, maybe not a Steve Carlton move, but of course Carlton has balks called too.
Did you make a good point just lobbing that ball over there, even with the short toss? Because Ramirez, even if he would agree to it, he has seen some move. Right now is the time to give him that move that pops the shoestrings.
3-2 the count. Nobody out in the first inning. And he goes, and the fastball is hit to right center field. Landro has a long way to come and can't get it. It's backed up by R.J. Reynolds. Ramirez will be stopped at third, and there are runners at second and third with nobody out. And the Dodgers are faced with the first inning blues again. That's hard to believe, isn't it?
It really is. And I tell you, I don't know if it was just me, as we watched Landro, I just couldn't get it. Look, that play was very slow in developing. Ramirez broke off first base. I didn't think he had an exceptional jump. The ball wasn't really stung. I didn't think Landro got that good a jump. I guess it's a day game after night game syndrome.
I was just going to say, Joe, it usually seems like the sloppy game of the week is the Sunday game following a week of night games.
Don't use that expression, sloppy game of the week.
I'll have to dress that up.
Yes, you will.
Uh-oh. There's a balk. He was so busy keeping a move that he balks in Rafael Ramirez, and Randy Johnson goes to third. And for the eighth time in nine games, the Dodgers have scored on in the first inning. In case you care, that's their first balk charged against Fernando this year.
Imagine that. There it was. Just seems starting to his move.
And as if things aren't tough enough, here's the hottest Atlanta hitter, Gerald Perry, who homered last night. He has 11 hits in his last 17 at-bats.
Here's the balk. Now watch him just start his move. You'll see it. And then he stops.
Boy, I didn't see it.
Well, he hasn't done it yet.
Oh, but the umpire was waving, so he did it already. See the umpire's hands go?
I didn't see it. I got to see it again then. Watch it.
The 2-0 pitch is low, ball three. So with the Dodger infield back, nobody out. Take a look.
I saw it the first time.
Look at that.
There it is. Right here. I saw it by the glove.
Wow. Terry Tatum must cut diamonds with eyes like that.
That's a good call.
Gee. 3-0 the count to Gerald Perry. 1-0 in favor of Atlanta. And with Randy Johnson balked to third, Fernando in a lot of trouble, have given up a couple. Fernando out of a stretch, and the 3-0 pitch, and he's missed with Gerald Perry. So Fernando, who has done very, very well on the road, struggled a bit at home in the padded trouble in the first inning. On the road, his ERA is less than a run, and he is 3-1. At home, it's almost 3.5, and he's 2-5. And now, as if he had enough trouble, here comes Dale Murphy. Murphy checking in against Fernando. It is 1-0 Atlanta. At 27, the youngest man to win back-to-back MVP awards. Ball one. At one stretch earlier this year, surprisingly enough, Murphy struck out in 15 straight games. He made an interesting observation. He was hitting about 220 when Horner came back and played a dozen games. While Horner was in the lineup and was red hot, he had 11 RBIs during those dozen. Murphy was also red hot. He hit over 330 and had four home runs. And Murphy was saying, when Horner's in the lineup, I get much better pitches. So immediately you say, well, it's going to be a tough year since Horner's not going to be there anymore.
Except that he knows he's not going to be there and he has to adjust.
The 1-0 pitch, ball two.
In great detail last night, he was talking about that he was trying to pull the ball so much that the only balls he was really driving were pitcher's mistakes. And you don't hit for high averages when you have to wait for the pitcher to make mistakes. Now, last night, he hit a ball, a home run, the opposite field, 385 marker. So if he goes the opposite way, he's going to hit a lot of home runs. If he tries to pull everything, he's going to be in deep trouble.
2-0 to Murphy with Johnson at third, Perry at first, to count 2-1. I would think we have two of the strongest young hitters with opposite field power in this game, with Dale Murphy and a member of the 30-30 club with 30 stolen bases and 30 home runs. And the other with the opposite field power, the left fielder for the Dodgers, Mike Marshall. 2-1 the count. Last night, they each homered to right center over that 385 margin. Three of Murph's 14 have gone to right or right center. Last year, he hit 17 of his 36 the other way. Boy, you really got to be able to hammer. 2-1. Screwball, a big chopper to Guerrero. Fair ball. The long throw to Brock in time. The second run scores. And down to second goes Gerald Perry.
Guerrero actually in foul territory when he throws that ball. Long throw, he gets his man. Ben, I can't help it. You know it better than I. Lasorda going through all these troubles. He tries to get out of everything with a joke, but the joke he tells really says it all when he says he calls suicide prevention, and they said, hey, we think it's a good idea. Jump.
Yeah. What did he say, too, about he called the president of El Salvador because he said, I wanted to talk to somebody who had more troubles in this world than I have. Well, the Braves have two, just like they did last night. They're leading 2-0, and they're not finished. Here is Chris Chambliss. 4-1. Chambliss does not hit Valenzuela at all. In fact, he doesn't have a hit in his last 20 at-bats against Fernando. And in his career, just 3-for-29. But he's still a pretty hot hitter. On the corner, 1-1.
The first pitch was a fastball. That was a curveball for a strike. And with Fernando, it's a tough pitch. The first time I saw it was Harry Brekina in the 46 World Series at Ted Williams, the left-hander throwing a screwball to the left-hand hitter because that's breaking into him. You always want pitches breaking away.
Here's the 1-1 pitch to Chris Chambliss, and that's hit foul off third down the line and back into the lower deck in the count 1-2. If you joined us a little late, Rafael Ramirez single to left. Randy Johnson doubled to right center, and then Fernando balked in Ramirez, Johnson taking third. Perry walked, and as Murphy grounded out to Guerrero, Johnson scored, and Perry took second. So it is 2-0 Atlanta, and we're just warming up the chairs. 1-2 to count to Chris Chambliss. Glenn Hubbard on deck, one out. And there's that Scroogey, Joe, and he kept it in.
And the target is the belt buckle. You've got to shoot for the belt buckle where it starts on the inside corner and breaks inside and ties you up. And it's a gutsy pitch, and obviously Valenzuela has great confidence in pitching it to Chambliss.
Two balls and two strikes to count it, Chris. Hard breaking ball away, 3-2. There's been a lot of talk about Chambliss and whether he would be traded. He's 35. And he has 2.5 years left on his contract. And look at that. Talking about working. Fernando's working hard here in the first inning.
Yes, he is. He wanted that 2-2 pitch for a decision.
Fastball got him. So he set him up inside, breaking ball away, challenged him with a fastball. That means Chambliss now is 0 for his last 21 against Fernando.
Even if he hits it, he doesn't drive this ball. Look where it is. I mean, he swung under it, but it was from the trademark in. Good pitch.
So Valenzuela takes care of Chambliss, but he's still not out of the woods by any means. He's given up two runs. And here is Glenn Hubbard. Tough little nut, plays second base at 5'8". Born in Hahn Air Force Base, Germany, he played Little League Baseball in Taiwan before coming to the United States. 4-1. And he was saying, you talk about pressure on Little League players in the United States, you should see the pressure they put on the Chinese kids in Taiwan. He said, it's unbelievable.
That's not fair. I don't care.
No. He played for the Air Force Little League team, not for the Chinese team. The 1-0 pitch. But no wonder, as he was speculating, why those Taiwanese kids would come over and always win the Little League championship. They treated them like adults, he said. They threw hard overhand instead of lollygagging the ball up to the plate like we would do a Little League.
They may have won it, but did they enjoy
it? That's right. Didn't have any fun. At second base, Gerald Perry. 2-0 Atlanta. They're having fun, just the start of things. And Scroogey is in there. 2-1.
You know, I saw a Little League coach with practice infield. He had get one, get two, and then says get three.
Get three?
When he said get three, I left.
Well, that's what Hubbard was talking about. Here's a 2-1 pitch. Fastball in there, 2-2. Glenn Hubbard, we're talking about what a tough nut he is to crack. He led all second basemen last year in RBIs with 70. National League All-Star team. A great little guy to watch play at 5'8". 2-2. Breaking ball missed.
Look at the Stone Mountain boys. I like that. He reminds me of the little soldiers every time I see him.
Remember the House of David?
Yeah.
Baseball team where everyone wore beards. 3-2 the count at Glenn Hubbard. Perry at second and two runs in the bank for Atlanta. Game three of the four-game series. 3-2. Fastball on the fists, hit foul off first. Brock will not be able to get under it, and it's going to go right off the lip of the dugout.
I can't help it when you said House of David. You know, they wore beards. That was the novelty then. Now everybody's got a beard, and nobody really thinks anything of it.
And remember, I think it was a rule that you had to be clean-shaven. And if I remember, now that could be wrong, of course, when Gary Maddox of the Phillies came back from Vietnam, he had a skin disease, so he couldn't shave, and they let him wear a beard. That's fouled off to the right and out of play. And it seems to me that when they allowed Gary to play with the beard, suddenly the mustaches became Fu Manchu, then the Van Goghs, then the beards.
Well,
the
Finley,
sideburns.
Remember to Charlie O, he was giving them bonuses, and Raleigh Fingers came up with that big mustache.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah,
he looked like Simon McGree. 3-2 the count to Glenn Hubbard.
I know railroad tracks.
2-0 Atlanta in the first inning. Screwball, and it's lifted to center field. Lando started to go back. Now he comes up. It's very tough looking into this birthday cake because of the multi-tiers here at Dodger Stadium and the colored shirts for the background. At the end of half an inning, 2-0, Georgia.
This is Mr. Goodrich, and did you know there are ways you can tell if your GM car's shock absorbers are okay? For one, check your tires. If they show unusual wear, like cupping at one spot, it can mean worn shocks. Make your car hard to handle. So see Mr. Goodrich. I have the right equipment, training, and genuine GM Blue Line replacement shocks available. They have a lifetime limited warranty.
It's another of Mr. Goodrich's good ways.
To keep that great GM feeling with genuine GM parts.
If you want the agent who gives you good neighbor service on your car, home, life, and health insurance, check with State Farm.
I'm State Farm agent Carl Cox. What sets State Farm apart is no secret. It's that good neighbor service State Farm is famous for. With State Farm, you have affordable protection that respects your budget. One agent who can do it all. Life, health, home, and car insurance. And just one number to call for that good neighbor service. Check with State Farm.
And like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
Rick Mahler is tuning up right now. He has a record of 4-1. He's won four straight, and here's the way the Dodgers will stack up. With R.J. Reynolds, last night's hero, in right field, Bob Baylor, the utility man, will spell Steve Sachs at second, and Greg Brock will be at first base. Mike Marshall, with a home run and a single last night, will be in left field. Kenny Landro, homered last night, is in center. Pedro Guerrero, the big gun that has been silenced, will be at third base. Mike Socia behind the plate. Dave Anderson will be at shortstop, and Fernando on the mound.
Defensively, the way they'll line up in left field, it's Perry. Murphy's in center field. Brad Kaminsk will be in right field. And then Randy Johnson in third base. Ramirez is the shortstop. Hubbard is the second baseman. Shambliss is the first baseman. And behind the plate, Bruce Benedict. On the mound, Mahler. Bob Gibson, the pitching coach, along with Rube Walker, very simply puts it, he was pitching backwards. He would nibble and then throw a fastball strike. He says you got to get ahead of the hitters. I don't care if it's a curveball or a fastball, but don't nibble first. Get the strike and then nibble.
He has also come up with a knuckleball, and he throws it maybe 12 times in a game just to show it to you, an extra pitch to think about if you're the hitter. R.J. Reynolds takes a strike. R.J., of course, singled up the middle against Gene Garber last night to win it. He had the most electrifying play of the year last year when he squeezed in a run in late September against Garber. Doing a good job. Switch hitter batting 293. And there's the bunt. Down to get it is Mahler, and the throw is in time.
Big guy got off the mound in good shape. It was his follow-through, it looked like from here. We'll see it on the replay that made that play. Now watch his follow-through as far as balance. He sees it, and he's able to break back. It was not that good a follow-through. He was breaking towards first base. Big hop, and he just does get him.
So Reynolds trying to bunt his way aboard. Mahler, Monday night in San Francisco, came within one out of a complete game. He beat the Giants 2-1, and his only loss was in his first start against the Mets. He lost 3-1, so he's pitched very tough. A strike to Baylor, who hits him fairly well, and he has a modest four-game hitting streak.
Both batters now, Reynolds and Baylor, he started off with a strike, both fastballs. I don't say that pattern will continue as far as being fastballs, but starting with the strike, that's what Gibson wants.
0-1. And a fastball at the chin, 1-1. He went 9 to beat Cincinnati, his fewest innings. He went 5 to beat the Cardinals. Most earned runs, 3 in that game against the Mets. Most walks, only 3 in that game against New York. Check swing foul. Most strikeouts, only 5. So in other words, he is not an overpowering pitcher by any means.
Has to change speeds, but he has to throw that fastball. I tell you, talking to Rube Walker and Bob Gibson, you really get a good insight on pitching. Gibson says, you know, a guy will nibble, then he'll throw the fastball for a strike, and he'll hit it, and he'll say, my fastball's killing me. Not the fastball that's killing you, it's that nibbling, and the hitter gets ahead of you, 2 balls and no strikes, 3-1, he guns you down.
Well, he's ahead 1-2 on Baylor, and that looked like the knuckleball. That's the first one we've seen. As you see the great, and I mean great, Bob Gibson looking for something, probably a hitter he knocked down.
You got to tell that story we were talking about, because Gibson, a tough competitor. In fact, he told one of his own pitchers.
1-2. And that's fouled away.
He told one of his own pitchers when he walked out to, he said, you're pitching so bad that if there weren't 35,000 people in the stands, I'd knock you right alongside the head.
I think he might have been the most aggressive pitcher I have ever seen.
Oh, he was tough. A good, tough pitcher. A real Hall of Famer.
1-2, the count to Bob Baylor. With Greg Brock on deck, 2-0 Atlanta in the first inning. Fastball just missed. You know, Gibson and I worked a playoff series years ago, and Gaylord Perry was pitching, and the rookie shortstop, Chris Spire, went to the mound, and I said to Bob, what could a first-year shortstop say to a veteran pitcher? He said, nothing. I got more than that. That's low. I said, when you were pitching, what would a young shortstop say to you? And Gibson looked at me in shock, and he said simply, I wouldn't allow it. And that summed up Bob Gibson. He wouldn't allow you to come to the mound without written permission. 3-2 to Baylor. Big chopper to third base. And that's where Randy Johnson hangs out. And you have 2 down in the first inning. Another thing, you know, I wondered, and Joe, you can tell me, do managers manage according to not just their personality, but their playing ability or their playing experience? The reason I wondered about this, it was turned out to be far-fetched, I guess. But I was looking at some stats, and it said last year that the Braves gave up the fewest intentional walks in the National League. Now, that's no big deal, except you get thinking like you study a general. And I thought, well, now, wait a minute. You got the most aggressive pitcher I ever knew in Bob Gibson. He hated to walk anybody. He challenged Aaron Mays, you name it. And you got a hitter who one year had 230 hits, led the league hitting .363, and won the MVP in Torrey. And, of course, no doubt he hated to be walked intentionally. That's a strike to Brock. And I wondered whether the chemistry of those two caused the Braves to be so stingy in intentional walk. And Gibby said, no, it just happened. But he said, I do see the point.
I see the point, too. You know, you can carry a step farther with Weaver. You know, they don't have many sacrifice bunts. Weaver says, you only get 27 outs. Why give one away?
That's outside. So then I look this year, although they have not allowed the fewest, they're still right down at the bottom. So they just don't give you the free ride.
I still think it's Gibson and Torrey's personality very, very much in that.
2-1. Miss, what about when you played and your various managers? Was there any particular manager whose personality was very evident in the way he managed?
Yes.
I have an idea.
Bill Meyer.
Oh.
And Phil Cabaretta. You thought DeRocher?
Yeah. There's a ground ball sharply. Look at Hubbard. Backhands it, throws him, and that's that. We ought to get back into that. But right now, the Dodgers go out in order 1-2-3. Coming up tomorrow, 2 hard-punching middleweights slug it out in the Windy City. Let's take a look.
Alex Ramos, the Bronx Bomber. John Collins, the big southpaw from the Windy City. Two middleweight contenders at the crossroads. On NBC Sports World, there is a world of difference.
I crushed a lot of quarterbacks in my day, and I'm real sorry. So I wrote this letter. Dear quarterbacks, I apologize for the way I treated you. Please let me buy you a light beer from Miller. Light's my beer because it tastes great. I'm sure it's yours, too, because you little guys can't afford to get filled up. See you soon. Sincerely, L.C. Greenwood.
Light beer from Miller. Everything you always wanted in a beer. And less.
Some people will go to great lengths to get a little peace and quiet. For them, we make a very quiet portable generator, the Honda EX650. It gives you all the conveniences of electricity without breaking the silence. It's lightweight, easy to use, and so quiet, you can even use it to run an electric blanket. And that's nice when the winter nights are 3 months long.
I hear that L.C. Greenwood has invited quarterbacks to join him for a light beer from Miller. Well, here's my reply. Dear L.C., I accept your gracious offer. A quarterback is far too intelligent to turn down a light beer because it's less filling and it tastes great. Even you big, clumsy linemen know that. Hope to see you soon. Sincerely, Bert Jones.
Come on, Bert!
Light beer from Miller. Everything you always wanted in a beer and less.
How'd he do that?
The thrill of a lifetime. That's young Mike Forzello, Joe Torre's godson, who is a bat boy today. And boy, was he having a time in a clubhouse before the game.
Brad Cummins gets a fly ball to center field, and waiting there is Kenny Landreau. So they go first ball swinging, and Cummins flies to center, one away.
Mike hustling those bats. Did you ever bat boy?
No, never.
Bruce Benedict.
There's the manager. He's watching the youngster.
You know, one thing in looking at Joe Torre, we mentioned his credentials as a player. For one reason and another, and there have been a lot of reasons, in the years he has managed in the big leagues, from August the 1st to the end of the year, 2 months, he has never had a ball club play 500 or better the last 2 months of the season, ever. And so even though they're out in front, and he's had clubs that played 600 ball up to the end of July, but once he turns a corner in August, strange things happen. And one of them, of course, the loss of Bob Horner.
Harry Wendelstedt called that strike. It was a half swing, as they put it, and they asked for a ruling, and Harry gave it to him.
0-1, the count to Bruce Benedict. Fastball missed. You know, I finally went to an umpire, and I said, what is a half swing? It used to be, as kids, they'd say you had to break your wrists. And I wondered if that's changed. Maybe it's the plane across home plate, and we got into a big discussion. Fly ball to Landreau, so it looks like he's going to be busy today. That's the second out. The umpire said, no. The only thought on the half swing is intent. If I think the hitter is actually trying to hit the ball, then I'm going to call the swing. Now, did you have half swings when you played, and were they reading minds and intent?
No, they didn't read many minds because there weren't that many guys thinking.
No, I'm not going to say the umpire's name, but that's what he said, intent.
Well, I know Jack O'Connell used to always say, no half swing. It's either a swing or it's not.
Here's Mahler taking ball one.
Just like there's no tie. You know, they say runner gets the tie. There's no tie at first base. Either safe or he's out, and he ain't nothing till I tell him. Amen, brother.
2-0 Atlanta in the second inning. One out. Now two, and the pitch is in there for a strike. 1-1 the count.
As you heard, Bob Gibson, one of the better hitting pitchers in the major leagues, Mr. Mahler.
The 1-1 pitch on the way. Fast one fouled away. Down the line out of play. 1-2. Mahler has one major league home run, and he hit it against Alejandro Pena, who pitches tomorrow. If I had to pick a National League hitting pitcher, I'd take Tim Lawlor of San Diego. Mm-hmm. He'd be number one. And you know the fellow they talk about? There's a youngster with Cincinnati, Jeff Russell. And they say that he might make it into big leagues as a hitter if he ever blew his arm out. It's still 2-0 in the middle of the second.
Now, Ford Ranger does it.
breaks out with a great low price. That's right, just $59.93 on the pickup with quality unbeaten by any major small truck maker. Based on a survey of owner-reported problems during the first 3 months, and Ranger has a wider cab than any small truck. Plus, power, payload, and tough twin I-beam suspension. Yes, Ford Ranger puts it all together. An 84 pickup at an 83 price. The best built American trucks are built. Ford Tough.
You are looking at the most advanced shock absorber that Monroe has ever made. Gasmatic. So advanced that in testing, people preferred the Gasmatic ride 3-to-1 over conventional shocks.
The difference was dramatic in the control, the stability, and the comfort.
A ride so superior, if Gasmatics don't give you the best ride ever, we'll replace them no charge. Monroe Gasmatic shocks and struts for the best ride ever. Guaranteed.
How old should your child be before you buy a computer? High school, when he's planning a career? Elementary school, when she can either fall behind or leap ahead? Or preschool, to give him a head start? When you buy is up to you, but Commodore makes the decision easier than any other computer. Because it's a 64, it's very powerful. Because it's Commodore, it's very affordable.
Len Berman in New York, bottom of the fourth at Fenway. Jim Rice base hit past Robin Yount. Wade Boggs scores it. It's 6-3 Red Sox over Milwaukee. For Jim Rice, his 1,000th career RBI. Let's go back to Los Angeles now.
All right, Len, will you talk about Jim Rice getting a single? We want to talk about an award that a thoughtful fan sent us, Ye Olde Grand Slam Award, to Joe Garagiola, the only balding former catcher now broadcasting, who has hit two Grand Slam homers during his baseball career, no fooling. And it was a very touching, sentimental award that I presented you today. I mean, the entire booth choked up.
I know it. And in the words of Johnny Logan, I will perish it forever. That wasn't accurate, though, Ben.
Really?
I'm not balding.
No.
I'm bald.
Oh, you mean it's all over, huh?
It's all over. Not any more INGs to it.
Here's Mike Marshall in the second inning. And a knuckleball outside, ball one, 1-0. Rice, last night, had two home runs and five RBIs. So he caught up to that 1,000th RBI in a hurry. A little dunker into right center. It's going to fall.
We asked Mahler what he has to do to be successful against these Dodgers. And here's what he thinks.
I'm the type of pitcher that has to change speeds and move the ball around and try to keep the ball down. And that's what I'm going to do today. I'm not going to pitch any different. I'll just do the same things that I've been doing all year.
The batter will be Kenny Landro. It's 2-0 Atlanta in the second inning. Landro in 9 of his last 11 and lines one into left field for a base hit. So the Dodgers have the tying runs aboard, nobody out. And the big gun that has not made very much noise so far this year, Pedro Guerrero, coming up.
Pedro Guerrero.
So Rick Mahler leading 2-0, facing Pedro, who, while still 2 years from free agency, signed the largest contract in Dodger history, 5 years for $7 million. And it's been a struggle for him. He's hitting .246. Fastball hit down to shortstop. Ramirez feeding Hubbard. He goes back to first, and the struggle continues, and the Wolves eat him up. Guerrero is hitting 180 with men in scoring position.
And that was just a perfect double play ball. You can see Ramirez gobble it up and just shovel it and showed Hubbard the ball all the way, and it was just a routine, easy double play. And Hubbard able to get that ball off before the base runner got there. First pitch swinging, I was kind of interested to see what Mahler would try to do, because if you do have to throw a fastball to Guerrero, there are all kinds of thoughts, because I asked three or four of the Braves pitchers. They felt Mahler had to stay inside with it if he threw it, and he did with that one and got the double play. He is just struggling, Ben.
Yeah, it's just awful for a guy, especially to sign that kind of a contract, because so much is expected of him. Ball one. Here is the leading Dodger hitter with men in scoring position, Mike Socia. He's hitting .389. where he has a chance to pick somebody up. But of course, right now, two out and Marshall at third. To give you an idea of how tough things have been around here, the Dodgers, prior to last night, scored as many as three runs only three times in 17 games. They finally got three runs in one inning last night and won, but they are anything but a machine. On deck is Dave Anderson, so let's see how carefully they're pitching Socia. That's a strike, 2-1.
And then one weapon that you used to always fear when you played the Dodgers hasn't been around, the stolen base. They really don't force you into a lot of errors.
And Lasorda, you saw that look of anguish on his face. He has tried just about everything imaginable to help Guerrero get out of the slump. Popped up on the left side, and here comes Johnson. The shades are down as he looks up into that bright sky, and the Dodgers blow the opportunity as Guerrero hits into the double play. So at the end of two, Braves 2, Dodgers nothing. We'll be back right after these messages from your local station.
Sunday, it's Wheels of Death as Kit storms the racetrack to stop a motocross murder. But can Michael stand the pace?
We're slipping!
On Knight Rider Sunday.
Local San Antonio Honda dealer today.
There is a bright new star which shines across Texas from dawn until dawn. It illuminates each highway, street, and sidewalk and touches nearly every home along the way. It is, they say, the new spirit of this great Texas city. The new spirit of San Antonio is here. Q96 FM, the new star of Texas and the best record collection in town.
Emily is better than it has to be. And there's only one kind of car that needs protection that good. One you have to keep. One you'd love to own. One you drive for work. One you drive for play. One you can drive for all it's worth. Because when it comes to protecting your engine better than it has to be, Emily is the one and only.
George McKenzie, News Center 4.
Braves leading the Dodgers with two runs in the first inning as we now go to the third. Rafael Ramirez, Randy Johnson, and Gerald Perry in that order. You know, Joe, earlier, just to get back to it and conclude the thought, we were talking about how you would study the opposing general to see how he might do under certain circumstances, and they study quarterbacks and coaches in football. Then we got to baseball managers, and you mentioned Billy Myers. Here's the pitch to Ramirez in the dirt. Ball one. In what way was his personality or his style of play reflected on the field?
Well, as a catcher, he always preached throw something besides the fastball when you're behind a hitter. And he preached moving the ball around, stay away from the double play.
Ground ball, foul, and the count 1-1.
It's not earth-shattering, but, I mean, he first and third, and the pitcher hit him. He'd bunt, make it second and third and two outs rather than get killed with the double play. Cabaretta, his imprint was just fire, battle, and not so much strategy as his own emotional feelings.
Screwball miss. And you didn't mention DeRosa, which surprised me.
The reason I didn't, I wasn't there that long. I was only there a month, and I really didn't see him in a stretch, but I will tell you what I did see in him that no other manager had.
Fastball is lifted to right field. RJ coming to the line, still coming, and makes the play.
The thing that Leo would do, if you'd go up there and let's say you swung at one pitch and missed it, and then you got two called strikes, you'd come back to the bench and for 20 minutes, Leo would say, what a cut you had at that ball. If you'd have hit that ball, you'd have driven it a mile. What a cut. It was perfect. All you had to do. And he had you so pepped up that you forgot about taking two strikes and just remembered that you had one good swing. So he was a great psychologist on that part. But I wasn't there long enough. I was only there a month.
Yeah, but that's a good point. Here's Randy Johnson, and he takes low, ball one, 1-0. I didn't realize. I thought, to be honest, most players played under DeRosa out of fear.
No, I would not say that. No way.
Here's the 1-0 pitch to Johnson. And that's laced into right field. So not only does he have a 10-game hitting streak, he's 2-for-2. You know, an amazing thing, Randy Johnson, the kid from Escondido, when he is a starter, the Braves record, not counting today, 19-3, and he's in the lineup.
And he just went with this pitch. You can watch it. Outside part of the plate, he just drove it to the opposite field. If he tries to pull it, he hits the ground ball. And here's Fernando's reaction when he'll look up and check with the with the sky or whatever he checks with.
No, and we know what it is. When he first came to the Dodgers, they painted an arrow under the bill of his cap, and he would look up the arrow to find out where home plate was. He just followed the line. Here's Gerald Perry, who followed the arrow and walked in the first inning. Check swing, but it's going to cost him a strike. 0-1.
He's got a great compact swing. You can see why Bob Gibson said in the given the lineups that they think this is going to be one of the outstanding hitters. He reminds me a whole lot of Gwynn of San Diego.
Well, you know, he was taken in the same 1978 draft along with Bob Horner and Steve Bedrosian. And he has baseball lineage. He's a nephew of Cincinnati's Dan Greason. At first base, there's Randy Johnson. One out in the third, 2-0 Atlanta. Fernando with his usual struggles in the first couple of innings. One ball and one strike to count. You folks in the East, why our weather does not compare the temperature with yours. It may be in the high 70s to 80 and very comfortable, no humidity here. I think the official temperature in Baltimore was 96. I don't know what it was down on the field. 1-1, the count to Gerald Perry. And Fernando still watching Randy Johnson. Last year, the Atlanta outfield, and of course then they had Brett Butler, but the Atlanta outfield, each man starting threesome, stole 30 bases. They're thinking steal now. So did the Cardinals starting outfield. What made it interesting, you had two teams with outfielders stealing 30 bases. The last time that happened was over 70 years ago when the New York Giant outfield had three guys who stole 30. We'll see if the Braves run now. Scotia is throwing well.
I'd say yes. Huh?
2-2. Scotia got a 50% of throwing people out, which is very good.
Reason I was so sure because young Perry in that batter's box was just thoroughly confused with everything that was going on after the pitch out.
Two balls, two strikes. Breaking ball. So he goes all the way to Perry. Now we'll see if Johnson is going. Since Fernando is usually around the plate, most teams will play run and hit. Figure you're going to get a pitch to hit.
Well, it depends on how often this kid strikes out.
Now let's just see.
If I had to bet, I'd say yes. And it's a big pitch because you got to strike him out and throw him out. Socia was not that accurate last night, but he got the ball there in good shape.
Perry is not a strikeout man. The runner goes on ball four. And quickly checking his numbers, he has struck out about 10% of the time. So first and second, and that's the second walk given up to Gerald Perry. So Fernando has got three hits, Dale two Murphy. Walks, a balk, and two runs. And it is 2-0 Atlanta. Now the challenge. Fernando against Dale Murphy.
Can't keep getting those base runners on and having this big guy come up there because he's going to hurt you and hurt you badly.
If he can win the Most Valuable Player Award this year, he'd be the first man in either league ever to win it three consecutive years. Screwball, and he missed with it, ball one.
Boy, I say it every time he comes up. I did a banquet. He was the peach of the athlete of Georgia. I think I got the award right, but what a speech he made. What a class kid. That's the word, class.
Yep, absolutely. He's everybody's favorite. One ball and no strikes to Dale. I didn't realize, I know he does everything well, but I didn't realize he was even an excellent slider. And the other night, he slid like Maury Wills, like a snake. One minute he was there, the next minute it looked like he was arriving from center field, and the throw had him beaten and he stole the base. So he's just one of those superbly gifted athletes. 1-1 to count to Murph. Fastball, foul back, 1-2. With everything else, you know, he's won a gold glove each of the last 2 years. He does it all, and they didn't really know where to play him when they first had him. Remember when he was a catcher?
Oh, his father had the great joke. He said he'd be a great thrower if they'd put the second base in center field.
So that's where he wound up.
Yeah.
1-2 to Dale. One out, we're in the third. Atlanta 2 and the Dodgers nothing, with Johnson at second and Perry at first. Fouled away.
But isn't it funny that when you can hit, how they find a place for you? I tell you, you can shake a tree and gloves will fall out, but it's hard to find those lumbermen.
Dale has not done particularly well against Fernando. He struck out about 25% of the time, and he has one home run lifetime. Hit way under his average. Braves 2, Dodgers nothing, top of the third. The Dodgers starting the day 2.5 back. And, of course, San Diego is very interested. They're just a half a game back of Atlanta. 1-2 to Dale Murphy with the left-hand hitting Chris Chambliss on deck. Now, remember, he really does a number on Chambliss. So the thinking is, well, if he gets by Murphy, then he can use Chambliss as the escape hatch and get out of the inning. But we'll see. 1-2. Screwball, and it's hit the center base hit. Here's Johnson around third to score. There won't be a play on him. Perry stops at second, and that Scrooge, you just hung there. You could have hung your hat on it.
There's no way that he wanted him to hit that ball. It was a screwball, and he got it up, and Murphy really widened his strike zone. This is not a strike, but it's not a good pitch because it's the high screwball. Now, look where it is. He just was protecting that plate. It's outside the strike zone, and he just put the bat on the ball. Sure that what Fernando wanted to do was break that screwball down, get the 2-2, and then make the pitch of decision, but Murphy wouldn't let him do it. He widened his strike zone and drove in the run. And that's what the big guys are supposed to do. Base on balls won't get the job done with men on.
So two singles and a walk have produced a run, and the Braves lead 3-0. And the Dodgers unhappy with Fernando's work, and they're going to heat up the bullpen. I know the telephone is ringing down there, and that's ball one to Chris Chambliss. Chambliss struck out. And as we said, he's 0 for 21 against Fernando, but a dangerous veteran hitter. Ball two.
This battle is going to be, and Socia's coming out to talk to him. He's got to start throwing some strikes, but this battle is going to be, will Chambliss guess right with Valenzuela? Because he knows he's going to come inside. He's come inside with the fastball, and now with two balls and no strikes, he can start to guess. Now he can play all kinds of games.
That's Rich Rodas, who was just called up from Albuquerque to fill in the gap because Jerry Royce went on the disabled list. So it is 3-0 Braves, and a poor offense can ill afford to fall this far behind, and the Dodgers struggling with the bat are down 3-0. Pickoff play at second, back to Anderson, not in time. You know, Chris Chambliss has hit 20 home runs in each of his last 2 years after never hitting that many in a season before. So Fernando has his hands full. Two balls, no strikes. Little foul off to the left out of play. And I guess a lot of people will never forget Chambliss hitting the home run of Kansas City's Mark Littell that won the 76th pennant for the Yankees. Bottom of the ninth inning, gave him 20 total bases for the five-game series, which was a record for one championship series.
Then here's where I would really be guessing if I were Chambliss. I'd be looking for a fastball inside and pulling my front foot back and just going to work on him. Anything else, I'm dead.
2-1 pitch, and he didn't get it, and it's ball three. I tell you, for somebody to guess, he's got over 7,000 at-bats in his career. So he's accustomed to all kinds of slots, but he didn't get that pitch.
Well, see, you guess. Now he got away with it if he was up there guessing, because the curveball was not a strike. He's 3-1. He can do it again. He can pick his pitch. That's why you have such an advantage when it's 3-1 or 2-0.
So Fernando's been pitching uphill ever since the anthem, and he's down 3-0 here in the third. Fastball, and he was a little bit late on it. 3-2. And in case you keep count of things like this, we're only in the third inning. And Fernando has made 65 pitches. So multiply that, and that's 195 pitches. And he ain't going to make it.
If he gets a strikeout here, he'd be out of the inning, though.
See if the runners go with one out now. 3-2. And here they go, and it's fouled away. So 3-2 with one away. Perry will go back to second, Murphy to first. So we'll see if they turn him loose again. This is the thing, a lot of people would correct you when you say it, but the Braves are playing run and hit. In other words, not hit and run, because the hitter is not obligated to swing at ball four. When you play hit and run, you got to go after it no matter where it is. The runners go, and the fastball got him. So should a Guerrero offline, and they get the double steal anyway, despite the strikeout.
He got the strikeout and should have had the double play, was what I was alluding to, because you know they were running. Socia's throw was not a good throw. It was to the third base side, and now Lasorda wants to come out and talk to him. Watch this throw. He had a good ball to handle. No reason for him to make that throw. He does a double step there. And the throw is not a good throw. Ball is there, but if it's on the bag, he's got him.
Now, Lasorda, who speaks a pidgin Spanish, I guess you'd call it, talking to Fernando, you got Glenn Hubbard and then Brad Kaminsk, and you have Rich Rodas down in the pen. But with two out, Lasorda wants Fernando to battle his way out of it. First base open.
He's giving him an option. Who would you rather pitch to, Hubbard or Kaminsk?
Hubbard has been slumping. Just three hits in his last, maybe six games, 25 at-bats. And Kaminsk is also slumping. He's just had two hits in his last 25, so take your pick. The veteran or the rookie. Fastball for a strike. Now let's just see something. Hubbard, lifetime against Valenzuela, is hitting 156. So that might have been part of the reasoning here. He flied to center in the first inning. He's away with the fastball, 1-1. On deck, there's Brad Kaminsk. He flied to center. 3-0 Atlanta with a chance to really open it up here in the third. Perry at third and Murphy at second. The screwball is popped up, and it'll be Dave Anderson, the shortstop. So he's out of the trouble cheaply enough. One run, two hits, and a walk, plus a double steal. And at the end of 2.5 innings, the Atlanta Braves 3 and the Dodgers nothing.
Now you can give Olympic gold and silver, because for the first time, the U.S. Treasury is issuing Olympic commemorative coins. They're beautiful gifts or keepsakes, and the precious metal you buy could help win Olympic medals.
Be part of the dream today.
Support the home team all the way home.
At many banks, coin dealers, fine stores, savings and loans, and post offices.
It's Sears' sizzling summer automotive sale. Get the power of Sears 60 battery, now just $49.99. Heavy-duty radial-tuned shocks, now $9.99 each. Two-ton floor jacks at half price. And Sears' tough new SuperGuard response radials, now at introductory savings from 20 to 30%. At Sears, we're installing confidence day and night.
There's more for your life at Sears.
If you've never watched soccer, you owe it to yourself to be there for this one on NBC Sports World, Sunday.
Talking about soccer, how about sock him? John Collins, a pride of the Windy City with a record of 31-1 and 27 knockouts. He'll go up against Alex Ramos on Sports World in that 10-round middleweight bout. That's all coming up tomorrow, 4 p.m. Eastern Time. 3-0 Atlanta in the bottom of the third. Dave Anderson, Fernando Valenzuela, and R.J. Reynolds against Rick Mahler. Anderson with an 8-game streak. And the bunt up on third. Good bunt. And he will beat it out. Mahler, I think, made it tough, too, on Randy Johnson.
He made it tough on him, Vin, but I don't think Mahler or Johnson. Beautiful bunt. The bat was parallel, and now Mahler sees that Johnson's going to make the play, tries to get out of his way, but he really deadened it, and there's nothing
that Johnson could do once he picked it up, but do what he did, he just couldn't get that much on it. That was a perfect bunt.
Seems like the bunt has almost disappeared because of artificial turf. I mean, as an offensive weapon, you don't see it nearly as much. And another one. And down to get it, Mahler says he'll handle it. And just does. Fernando just missed out legging it. It'll go as a sacrifice, but very close.
Hey, you gotta like the way Fernando went down the line. Most pitchers, when they lay down a bunt, they want to hold a press conference and say, look at a nice bunt, and my job was to get the guy over. He's not satisfied with that. He's really digging hard, and Mahler kind of let up a little bit, and it's very close at first base. He gets him, but not by much. Good hustling by Fernando.
So with one out and Dave Anderson at second base, the Dodger bench coming alive as Fernando bearing down. That's Jerry Royce wearing the dark glasses, and then Rick Monday. The batter is R.J. Reynolds. He tried to bunt in the first inning. Evidently, the Dodgers feel that Mahler perhaps is not a particularly good fielding pitcher because Reynolds tried to bunt for a hit. We saw Anderson bunt for a hit. We saw Fernando make it very close. So that's part of the attack, evidently. Ball one. RJ, who singled home two to win last night's game, is hitting over 350 with men in scoring position, so he's trying to pick up Dave Anderson at second base. One ball, no strikes. That's in there.
The bunt for the base hit is a whole lot like the stolen base. It's a commercial for the next game. I mean, that's one of those things they talk about in the meeting, and the infielders will shorten up. Pitchers will think about it. It's a good play.
One ball, one strike. There's a look, and it's in there. I had asked Bruce Benedict about whether he would wear the big waffle mitt or not now that Rick Mahler has been a knuckleball pitcher. And Benedict said no, because, as you see, he's using the orthodox mitt. He said Mahler will only throw that knuckleball about a dozen times. And there it is.
There it was. You can see him grip it.
And then I said, well, what's the bottom line? When do you decide to wear the knuckleball mitt? He said, it has to be with a pitcher who will throw it 50% of the time. And, of course, he handled Necro, so it figures that he's going to be here handling Mahler. 2-2. Reynolds trying to pick up Anderson. It's 3-0 Atlanta in the third inning. Knuckleball. And now I guess he's thrown more in this game than the Dodgers had expected. Let's take another look at that wobbler.
Second baseman.
Well, he said he was going to throw it when he had two strikes on him. Here you see it come. See, it's really the fingernail. We call it the knuckleball, and it just breaks straight down. I mean, it was more like a curveball. It didn't just float up there and skyride as it came dancing up there. But I tell you, once you're in that batter's box and you see that ball coming up, and you see the seams, and it's like fire. You know, when somebody hollers fire, you say, knuckleball, knuckleball, and your whole body reacts to it.
Well, here's Baylor playing instead for Steve Sachs. He grounded a third in the first inning, 0-1. Fastball for ball one. If Fernando watches the Dodgers leave a man in scoring position, it will not be any news to him. The Dodgers have scored one run or less in six of his last seven starts. Remember, they had first and second and nobody out in the second, and Guerrero hit into a double play. Now they have a runner at second with one out, and Reynolds strikes out. So Fernando is getting accustomed to being hit over the head. Two balls and no strikes to Bob Baylor. On deck, Greg Brock. Mahler had a brother, you might remember, who pitched with the Braves, Pirates, and Angels, brother Mickey. Ball three. Mahler spent the first month of the season in the bullpen, and he has really been discovered as a starter now. He's done exceptionally well. Lifetime 4-1 against the Dodgers. And so Baylor walks, and the Dodgers get a chance to get back in the game. Brock is the kind of hitter. If he gets lucky, he gets even. Among those who had to go on the shelf, he sprained his right wrist on May the 12th, so he's really just coming back. Grounded out in the first inning, and he finds Anderson at second and Baylor at first with two out. 3-0 Atlanta. Ball one. They're going to check, and a swing is called, so he couldn't hold up on a bad pitch. And that's Bob Davidson at third calling the strike.
Yep,
yeah, he had the intent. I could read his mind.
I knew you were going to say that, too. 0-1 the count. And time called. I wonder, we probably have umpires watching this game today in hotel rooms all around the big league. I wonder if they would agree with the man I was talking with about the half swing or whatever you want to call it is based strictly on intent. Wow. 0-1 to Brock. Anderson at second, Baylor at first, two out in the third. The Braves, 3 runs, 4 hits. The Dodgers, no runs, 3 hits. 0-1. Fastball, just to show it to him, 1-1. As we mentioned earlier, he's not at overpowering pitchers. Most strikeouts in a game, 5. His best game so far this year, a complete game 4-hitter against Cincinnati. That was the beginning of the Braves' 9-game winning streak. Boy, they just ate up Cincinnati. They went into Ohio and won 5 straight. Then went to San Francisco and won 3, and then came here and won Thursday. Brock pays the price. He has struck out a third of the time now in his last 17. But, of course, as we said, he can get you healthy. Fouled away.
You like to watch a guy like Mahler pitch because he moves that ball around, has an idea. The count, 1 ball and 2 strikes. You can almost see him on that pitch say, I'm not going to give him a strike to hit at. If he wants to chase a bad ball, let him chase it. And if anything, it's going to be low and outside, something that he can't pull. He's going to have to chase a bad ball and go the opposite way. Good pitching.
1-2 to Greg Brock. And he hits it over the head of the shortstop Ramirez for a base hit. Anderson scoring, and Baylor goes to third. 3-1, Atlanta.
Came right back and made the one pitch he didn't want to make right down the middle, and Brock was there ready to hit it. It was belt high, a fastball, and you could see him. Mahler is disgusted, and he should be, because he had him crippled and let him get away. Watch where this pitch is. You couldn't pick up a phone and call for one better than that. Right down the middle. Just like the other pitch was good pitching, that was bad pitching.
So Fernando finally gets a run. It is 3-1 Atlanta. And now Mike Marshall, who is certainly the big guy on the squad, coming up. He's had 9 home runs in just his last 84 at-bats. Ball one. So he has really been the power plant.
Not to belabor the point, but Ben, that's what players mean when they say, I hit a pitcher's mistake. I don't care how good it was, the location was terrible, that was a mistake, and Brock was ready and he hit it, and that's what big leaguers do.
The pitch to Marshall is sliced foul off to the right out of play, and the count 0-2. Mike singled in the second inning. Remember, we were talking about Marshall and Murphy, two of the best in the league, opposite field power. He's been the Dodger RBI leader throughout the year. He has 11 home runs, 30 RBIs. Despite missing 3 weeks, he remained atop the heap. Good pitch in on the hands, 1-2. The whole time he was out, as you see Landro on deck, Marshall retained the club home run lead. The whole time Greg Brock was out, he remained second.
Let's see what he does with Marshall with the count 1 ball and 2 strikes. That was a count on Brock.
Baylor down the line from third, Brock at first, on the hands with the fastball. He really tied him up. He never had a good swing at it. So Mahler makes a good pitch to tie up Marshall, and he's out of the inning. The Dodgers get a run on 2 hits and a walk and leave 2. And at the end of 3, Braves 3, Dodgers 1.
How can a guy 5'9 have an unfair advantage over these guys? I use the Gillette Atra razor. They don't. It's got the advantage of a pivoting head. Atra is better than twin blade razors that don't pivot. See? They don't always stay in my beard, but my Atra pivots to keep both blades on my beard longer. So I get a better shave. Close. Comfortable.
Get the Gillette Atra and get the Atra advantage.
Sometimes a little advantage goes a long way.
You work hard. Working hard against the clock could mean perspiration odor. Gillette's Right Guard stick is so potent, one application destroys odor-causing bacteria on contact and for up to 24 hours.
Both neighbors just bought garage door openers. Ralph bought old-fashioned chain drive. But Herb got Genie Track Drive, the chainless opener. Herb's lucky. Track Drive really is the easiest to install and never needs grease or adjusting. Buy Track Drive and get a little help from me. Or buy Chain Drive and go it alone. Track Drive, the easiest to install. Only Genie has it.
Tomorrow live, the 1984 French Open Championship. Ivan Lendl of Czechoslovakia after his first Grand Slam title against John McEnroe. Will he become the first American man to win the French in almost 30 years? Lendl McEnroe for the French Open title, 9 a.m. live in the East, 8 in the West in Central Time Zones. Right here on NBC.
Yes, that's going to be great to see whether McEnroe can become the first American male to win the French Open since 1955. Meanwhile, it'll be Brad Kamins, followed by Bruce Benedict and then Rick Mahler. And here's ball one. 3-1 Atlanta. Kamins was brought up when Claudel Washington went on the DL. Washington was hitting 340 and had 8 home runs and 40 RBIs. He had a severely pulled hamstring. So Kamins playing right field. But boy, when Washington comes back, and he might be back when the Braves go home, they'll be much better off because Claudel has the numbers and the experience as well. Kamins hit his first home run of his career Tuesday night in San Francisco against Scott Garrell. 1-2. Screwball. 2 balls, 2 strikes. The Braves on the DL, well, they've had Bob Horner twice, and of course he's lost for the year. Claudel Washington, Rick Camp, Terry Harper, Terry Forster, Donnie Moore, and Randy Johnson. They have really been beaten up. That's squirted foul. The Dodgers have had Jerry Royce, he's on it now, Bob Baylor, Mike Marshall, Greg Brock, Bill Russell, Mike Socia, and Ken Landrum. It is indeed the battle of survival.
It really is. Boy, that Horner, I feel badly about it. I feel badly about all of them, but especially him. He just hadn't had good luck.
Do you know, you talk about good luck. He will have missed, because of injury, when this season ends, 279 games in his career because of injuries. I mean, it's really just unfair. And Horner kills Valenzuela. Ball three.
And they're all, you know, they're big injuries. They're not little trivial things.
Boy, you're so right. Second time breaking the navicular bone in his wrist. 3-2. Fastball. Strike three call. So we have one out in the four. 3-1 in favor of Atlanta. Let's go to New York.
Bruce Benedict.
Thank you, Vin. A scary moment in Baltimore. Al Bunbury lines it right off the side of Juan Berenguer's head. Berenguer got himself up, dusted himself off, started all over again, and gave up a run to the Orioles. Baltimore leads at 1-0 in the fourth. Back to L.A.
All right, Len, I'll give you a scary moment. How about outfielder Eddie Milner of Cincinnati? Rick Rodin threw a fastball. It hit him on the jaw. It knocked out a filling, and he just went to first base. Didn't run.
That's got to make Rodin feel great. He's throwing his best fastball. He knocks a filling out.
Knocked a filling out.
And they're putting guns on these guys to see how fast they're throwing, these radar guns.
The strike one pitch. Strike two to Bruce Benedict, who fly to center. If Fernando follows his normal route, he will now settle down. In other words, his troubles always come in the first couple of innings, it seems. 0-2 to Benedict. Fastball got him looking. That's 5 strikeouts. That means he has struck out 3 of the last 4 hitters.
And he's really placing the ball well now. Watch this pitch. Look where the target is. Right there. He wouldn't have had to move the glove at all.
You know, though, it's such a familiar pattern, it drives Lasorda and Ron Paranoski to distraction. Why? Why does it take you so long to get on the beam? And especially with a club that doesn't score a lot of runs, you can't afford to give them up early. Here's Mahler. He struck out in the second. There's a strike.
And the obvious thing is, well, he doesn't loosen up enough. That isn't it. Everybody's watching it. I've seen pitchers do that when they have the trouble. They start earlier, they throw more pitches, they throw less.
Fouled away, 0-2. So he has a shot at striking out the side now. I don't know, maybe it's concentration. Maybe some people just suddenly can't walk in and be 100% mentally prepared. I don't know. 0-2. Got him, and he strikes out the side. That gives him a half a dozen strikeouts. Remember, his high this year, 15 against Philadelphia, and he did it with 11 pitches. And at the end of 3.5, Braves 3, Dodgers 1.
Trip was a good idea. Yeah, it sure is relaxing.
Peaceful. Groovy.
Groovy? Kind of dark, though. Man, I'm getting thirsty. Yeah, let's have another light beer for Miller.
Light Fresh Philly!
Fresh Philly! Fresh Philly! Fresh Philly!
What was that?
The creature.
What creature?
Well, legend has it that a horrible thing stalked these woods.
Oh, Mickey!
And it comes out when the moon is full.
What does this creature look like?
It walks on two legs, but it isn't human. It's got big eyes that bulge out and...
It's the creature!
Hey, guys, where are you going? Hey, guys, where are the marshmallows?
Light beer from Miller. Everything you always wanted in a beer, and less.
Come on, it's after us! Man, did you see that thing?
Len Berman in New York and Dwight Evans for the Red Sox shows you why it's not the left field line that has the shortest home run at the wall in Fenway. It's right down the right field line, just 302 feet. Boston takes the 8-6 lead over the Brewers. Back to Los Angeles.
Well, Len, I guess it's things like that that has kept Dwight Evans in his 12th year with the Boston Red Sox. One of the veterans with the Sox and a big man in Beantown. Boston has won 8 out of 10, so they're trying to make a move. Coming off 14.5 games off the pace. 3-1 Atlanta, and in the bottom of the fourth, Kenny Landro, followed by Pedro Guerrero and then Mike Socio. Mahler in trouble the last two innings. Got it over, 0-1. Landro singled in the second inning. He is kind of an enigma when you see him every day. You really wonder why he doesn't hit 300. It's a ground ball down to Hubbard, who retreats and then throws him out. One down, and it'll bring up Pedro Guerrero. Of course, talking about
Pedro
an enigma.
Guerrero.
Here is the biggest problem for the Dodgers, and of course, Pedro has done almost everything imaginable. Lasorda has given him extra hitting. Mota has tried to help him. They've even dropped him to the number 6 slot to take some heat off him. But it's the old trouble. It seems like when you have a man in a slump, you can't hide him. He keeps coming up with men in scoring position. 4-1.
Goes back to playground days. You always put the fat kid in right field, but then when the game was on the line, the ball was always hit to the fat kid.
The fat kid in right field. Pedro does have a very modest four-game hitting streak, and as you can see, look at his numbers. Right. And you have to remember that he provided the Dodgers with an awful lot of sock, not only those numbers, but the long ball. I mean, he's a 30-home run hitter for 2 years. Second year in a row, he hit 32 in 83, following 82. That's one short of Steve Garvey's record. But there are some big hitters in baseball who are struggling. He's not the only one. Andre Dawson, George Henry come to mind immediately. A one hopper to the hole, backhanded by Ramirez. The throw got him on a good play.
What a major league play that was. We talked about Ramirez. They talk about his errors, but that's the kind of thing he can do. That ball well hit, backhands it, braces himself, fine arm, and throws the strike. And I tell you, it's not even close.
Perfect play. Big league shortstop, all right, Senor Ramirez. And with two down on the fourth, 3-1 Atlanta. Here's Mike Socia, who fouled out in the second inning. Off speed and high, and looking at the book, the Dodgers have been able to hit one ball in the air. It was a foul ball. Socia hit it, and Randy Johnson caught it. they're having a lot of trouble with Mahler, 2-0. Three runs, four hits for Atlanta, one run, four hits for the Dodgers. Mahler has walked one, struck out one. Little foul, out of play. Two balls, one strike. Kind of an interesting anniversary. We were talking about the Red Sox before. On this date, actually yesterday's date, in 1950, would you believe the Red Sox beat the St. Louis Browns 29-4? Can you remember the most one-sided game you were ever in? I mean, 29-4.
That's really one-sided.
2-2. Knuckleball, pull to the hole. Hubbard knocks it down. That's all he can do with it. Great effort. And Socia base hit.
Shortstop, Dave Anderson.
College World Series last night was 15-13. And then Arizona State beat Oklahoma State, one of the teams that played in that game. What was it, 23-12 or something?
Some wild number. Well, this is just about the anniversary of that game in Fenway. Bobby Doerr hit three home runs. Ted Williams and Walt Dropo each hit two. 29-4 over the Browns. Meanwhile, we're 3-1 Atlanta in the fourth inning, and a strike to Dave Anderson. Remember, he had the bunt single in the third inning, so he's hit in nine straight, and he scored the Dodger run. 1-1. If you're in Chicago, you might remember this date in 1963. Ernie Banks hit three home runs in a game against the Dodgers, but the Cubbies lost. On this date in 1946, Mel Ott was managing the Giants. They played a doubleheader, and he was kicked out of each game. Were you ever kicked out of a game?
Oh, yes.
Were you?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Pretty hard to keep that Italian calm and
no.
Check all the time.
Dumb questions that I asked.
Hale Murphy waiting. There's the third out. You mean my question was dumb or
no,
yours?
No, my question that I asked the umpires. Okay. That's what gets you kicked out.
No runs, one hit, and a man left. And at the end of four, Braves 3, Dodgers 1. We'll be back after these messages from your local station.
Sunday, Robert Blake. Joe Dancer.
Private Dick.
He's taking rear guard action with babes, bullets, and bad guys and running for his life.
Boss on a cattle drive. You put in long days under the big sky, and when the work's over, you head for the mountains.
Bush.
Head for the beer that goes down smooth as a mountain stream. Brewed the natural way so it's always as smooth as its name.
Bush. Head for Bush beer.
You got a right to chicken done right.
I make it tender, juicy every bite.
I make fresh hot biscuits
and tasty fresh coleslaw.
You got a right to chicken done right.
Nobody makes chicken like we do with the Colonel's Secret blend of herbs and spices.
It's finger looking good.
Kentucky Fried Chicken, we do chicken right.
Gillespie Ford is overstocked with more new Fords than any dealer in San Antonio. Come in now and drive away in a new Ford for less than $160 a month, like a Tempo sedan for $158 per month, or this 84 Escort hatchback for a low $135 per month. This Ranger pickup is available for only $135 per month. See why Gillespie is number one in Ford sales for the past 8 years. Gillespie Ford, selling more cars and trucks for less.
You can afford a Ford when you buy from Gillespie, when you buy from Gillespie. You can afford a Ford.
Rick Lozano, new center four.
Fifth inning here at Dodger Stadium, and it'll be Rafael Ramirez going head-to-head against Fernando Valenzuela. Rafael singled and scored a run. He was actually balked in from third, and last time up flied to right. Last year, Ramirez wore out the Dodgers. He hit 371 against them, and he's doing the same thing now in the first series. He is 7-for-12 against Dodger pitching. We were talking about being kicked out of a game, Mel Ott being kicked out of each game of a doubleheader. And you said, oh, sure, I've been kicked out for dumb questions. I got to pursue that. 1-0 pitch. Screwball for a strike. One and one.
Well, I tell you.
Give me a for instance.
I'll give you a for instance. It had nothing to do with the ball game. It was in Brooklyn. I was with the Cubs. Phil Cavaretta was our manager. Frank Descoli was the umpire, okay?
1-1. Fouled away.
And I'd been jawing back and forth, and finally I said something. I'd not been kicked out yet. I walked out to the mound. Descoli came out to run me back behind the plate. And I started arguing with him, and I said, well, you made such a lousy call. If you had any guts, you'd change your name. He said, get out of here. And Cavaretta came out and wondered what was going on. And I said, he's gutless. He won't change his name. Now, what's that got to do with the game?
That you got kicked out.
Launched.
And they still put you in the Italian Hall of Fame?
Not yet.
Not yet. Okay.
They're holding out.
2-2 to Ramirez. Remember Al Barlick, how low-keyed he was? Ha-ha. Ground ball under the glove of Fernando, and there he goes again. The Rafael Ramirez hits like Rogers Hornsby, at least, against the Dodgers. He is 8 for 13 in this series after hitting 371 last year against them.
Guerrero, he gave it an effort, but he didn't have a chance. He was playing wide in the bag, and Ramirez just drilled it past him.
Now that's five hits. Ramirez at second, nobody out. And Randy Johnson, who doubled in the first inning, coming up. Johnson followed by Gerald Perry and then Dale Murphy. Three runs, five hits for the Braves. One run, five hits for the Dodgers. Tried to go to right field with the fastball and came up empty.
He'll try it, I think, with at least until he gets two strikes, Vin, because you got your third, fourth, and fifth place hitters coming up there, and this is a spot where the guy has to give himself up.
And he's already 2-for-2 with a double and a single. Guerrero is about even with the bag at third. And there's the bunt. And down to get it is Fernando, and the play will go to Greg Rock. So the Dodgers were sensing the bunt. They figured, okay, he had his shot to go to right, and he fouled it off, so now get the bunt down.
Almost,
one away.
Almost looked like he was bunting for the base hit, but I'm sure that if they were going to get an out, they were going to pick up a base. And the Braves did that, and now you got your gunners up there to drive it in, pick up that run that the Dodgers picked up in that third inning.
The infield is up now here in the fifth inning. Gerald Perry has walked twice, probably the fastest man on the Braves squad, so he puts a little heat on the infield. You have to handle the ball cleanly. And he hits it foul off third, out of play. 0-1. So Ramirez at third, one out, top of the fifth inning. Braves 3, Dodgers 1.
That tells you something about Mr. Perry, who walked in the first inning, he walked in the third, but with a man on third, he's not up to the walk, and he went to work on the very first pitch near that strike zone. He's going to try to knock that run in.
Look at those numbers. Swings and misses, 0-2. You know you've got yourself a hot, hungry hitter up there. So Gerald Perry. No balls and two strikes. Ball one. When he homered June 5th, it was the first home run from a left fielder that Atlanta got this year. They'd had Albert Hall out there and Terry Harper and Brad Kaminsk. And Gerald Perry now trying to find a home. 2-2.
Socia really making sure that the breaking ball, as we look at Dale Murphy in the on-deck circle, Socia going to the breaking ball, making sure that he was going to be outside the strike zone if he missed. 2-2, he's got to get a decision right about here, though.
Got him. And for Fernando, he has struck out 7. Remember, he struck out the side in the fourth inning on 11 pitches.
I asked Murphy with Horner out if he's widened his strike zone. I think he has. Here's what he said.
Well, my strike zone is pretty wide anyway. I think it goes from my forehead to my big toe, but... I've always kind of been aggressive, and I have to stay that way, really. And I found that I haven't really been contributing too much, and I want to make sure I stay aggressive. So I think we need to think a little bit different as a lineup now without Bob. You know, be aggressive up there, run the bases a little bit more, and just make the best of it.
Well, they're going to take the bat right out of your hands. When he talks about a strike zone from his eyeballs to his toes, he's 6'5", so that's a pretty good strike zone anyway. And this time, he's not a... What is the old line? He's not afraid of height, he's afraid of width. And there's going to be four wide ones to load the bases. Make it first and third, excuse me. So first and third, two out, and we shall break our concentration to New York.
Well, Vin, remember that Dwight Evans spot that he hit his homer to a few minutes ago? Bill Buckner says I can do the same thing. Same place, right down the right field line. It's now 11-6 Boston. They're playing the seventh. Back to you.
Well, remember, Len, we told you that it was in 1950, on June the 8th, when the Red Sox scored 29. So maybe they're trying to celebrate. And here is Chambliss on a half swing, full swing, says Bob Davidson, the count 0-1. And Chambliss has struck out twice today. He take another look at the swing.
Let's see here. I don't know about the intent this time.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it didn't go around, but I think he had the intent.
Intent.
Yeah.
First and third, two out. He got the intent to lift a high fly ball to right center. And Landreau looks over at RJ, who makes the catch. Normally, you expect the center fielder to be the captain on a ball like that, but he gave way to the rookie. Two left, and it remains 3-1 Atlanta, bottom of the fifth.
People tend to confuse me with the roles I play, which is ridiculous, because I'm not a neat freak. For example, I just got a Beta Zoom copier from Enalta, but not because I can add toner without getting that disgusting black powder all over my hands. No, I got a Minolta Beta Zoom because it takes this mess of different size originals and gives back copies in one neat size, automatically. But that doesn't make me a neat freak. Of course, I'm not a slob either, like,
The Beta Zoom copiers, only from the mind of Minolta.
I mortgaged my house to get my first tug. Believe me, the Genie T needed plenty of work.
Good night, Skipper.
Today, I own two others just like her. Because we give our customers a good, honest pull for the money, and that pays off. People who make Meisterbrow work the same way. These days, I can pick any beer I want. This tastes as good as Budweiser, and it doesn't cost as much. Gentlemen, the drinking lamp is lit.
Meisterbrow tastes as good as Budweiser at a better price.
There we were in no man's land, when the moving truck died in the sun and the sand. So since it seemed we'd be a while, we set up house and we waited in style. And we waited, and we waited, and we waited. Now I know Ryder rents some newer. They're tougher, they're strong. And driving a bargain sure didn't pay. So next time I'll think this way, it's Ryder or it's wrong.
Ernie Banks sets the stage for our doubleheader.
We got the set in, sunshine, fresh air. We got the team behind us, so let's play two.
Philadelphia battles the Cubs, or Pittsburgh at Montreal. Then the White Sox take on Oakland, or Baltimore faces the Yankees. The teams are here.
And, of course, we'll be in New York with Baltimore, so that's going to be a big day next Saturday while we find out about the outcome of this game.
Oh, we'll meet in the players' lounge at Yankee Stadium.
Oh, yes, yeah, the George Steinbrenner room. How could a nice Italian boy like you ask Ascoli to change his name? There's a drive to left, but Gerald Perry has it under control, and that will do it, as R.J. Reynolds will now come up after Fernando lines to left. One away.
You started telling me about Al Bartlett being reserved. Now, that's one thing about Al. You always knew whether it was a ball or a strike. If you didn't see it, you could hear him.
Well, you know, the thing you were talking about getting thrown out or asking a question. We did a game that seemed like 1,000 years ago in Milwaukee with the Milwaukee Braves. And Johnny Logan led off the game, and Bartlett was the plate umpire. And the very first pitch, there were 40-some-odd thousand people in the ballpark, and the first pitch was a strike. And Logan turned his head, and Bartlett threw him out of the game. First pitch. So I couldn't wait when the game was over to ask Bartlett, what was it Johnny Logan did that you'd kick him out on one pitch? He had hardly moved in the batter's box. 4-1. Bartlett said, Logan turned and said, you call another one like that on me, and I'll pinch your head off. Can you imagine saying that to Bartlett? One ball and no strikes to R.J. Reynolds. Al's growing tomatoes now.
In Springfield, Illinois.
And RJ tried to bunt his way aboard and struck out, so he's 0 for 2, hitting 286. Tries it again.
Why isn't he in the Hall of Fame?
I don't know.
Al Bartlett.
I don't know.
He's a great umpire.
Oh, boy. RJ Reynolds. Trying to get something started, one out in the fifth inning. The Braves, 3 runs, 5 hits. Dodgers, 1 run, 5 hits. And on deck, Bob Baylor. Fastball, line, backhanded by Hubbard. Hubbard had to see that ball coming off the bat immediately. There had been a split-second hesitation, it's true.
He makes a good play. He's just a good ball player. That says it all.
Yeah, I really admire him, especially when they take shots at him and he's the middle man on a double play out there. He refuses to give. I mean, you can try and knock his beard off and it won't make any difference. You really have to admire him. Here's Baylor. Grounded out and walked 0 for 1. Ball 1. Braves scored twice in the first inning, in case you weren't with us. Ramirez singled and Johnson doubled. A balk got one home. A ground ball got Johnson home. There's a one hopper into left field for a base hit. Now remember, all three balls in this inning have been pretty hard hit. Fernando lined out to left, Reynolds lines out to Hubbard, and now base hit to Baylor. If you wonder why Baylor is in the game, not only the fact that Sachs has been slumping a little bit, but the Dodgers went back to the records and found out, although they haven't had very head-to-head meetings, Baylor is now 4-for-6 lifetime against Mahler. Boy, those computers come in handy. And here's Brock. Ball one. Now, Brock grounded out, but then got a good pitch and singled in the third inning to drive in the Dodger run. Hitting 207. 3-1 Atlanta, bottom of the fifth. Two out. Well, the bottom dropped out of that thing.
Change speeds. He keeps that ball down where he threw that one. He's going to be tough.
Baylor at first, held on by Chris Chambliss. Ball two, 2-1. Basically, I guess it's a generalization, but left-hand hitters like the ball down, right-hand hitters like the ball up. There's no rule that's written in stone. 2-1.
Another one.
2-2 the count. On deck, Mike Marshall.
Would you come back with the same pitch now? 2-2.
I wouldn't mind, yeah. He's had two bad hacks at
right.
it. Why not? And there goes Baylor. And there goes the ground ball base hit into right field. So Baylor just keeps on going to third. And the Dodgers are in business for Mike Marshall.
The ball just seemed to hang up there. It looked like a curveball. And here comes Bob Gibson out to talk to him. And this will not be anything about mechanics. This will be a quick seminar on winning, concentration, and bearing down.
So Bob Gibson talking to Rick Mailer with Donnie Moore in the bullpen. You know, we talked about Bob Gibson, about our tremendous respect for the Hall of Famer. Let's put it this way. 1 year, Bob Gibson's record with the 1968 St. Louis Cardinals. Gibson won 22 games, made 34 starts, completed 28 of the 34 starts, and you know what his earned run average was? 1.1. I mean, how much better in the world can you be?
Here's that last pitch. Watch it hang. It looked like a curveball. It's up there. See it. It was a breaking ball. He got it above the belt, and that's always dangerous territory.
So Gibby's back in the dugout, and Mahler up to his hips in trouble. With first and third and two out, Mike Marshall trying to get the Dodgers back in the game. Fouled away. Marshall has singled and grounded out. 1-for-2.
That ground out, remember, that was the ball that he got the fastball in on his hands with the count of one ball and two strikes, really jammed him, and he hit the ground ball to the second baseman. That's the pitch that he wants to come back with.
Marshall last night got a similar pitch that he fought off and blooped for a base hit to right. He's that kind of a hitter. And he is jammed and hits one foul, but will be out of play.
This, to me, is the beauty of baseball right now, Ben. Two strikes, the count on Marshall. He's a guy who can drive the ball out the ballpark. It's a battle between Mahler and Marshall. How will Benedict set up Marshall? It's a real war going on.
And the tying runs are aboard, just to add spice to it, with Brock at first and Baylor at third. 0-2. Ball one. It looked like a knuckleball.
It was either a knuckleball or a breaking ball. He was going to be out of the strike zone, hoping that Marshall would change it. Now, Benedict does a good job blocking it. Now, he gets that whole body in front of it. He doesn't want to catch that ball. He wants to do exactly what he did, block it. Now, that pitch is setting up. I would say he's going to go to 2-2, but you never know. I mean, that's what I would do. I would come back with another curveball, bad curveball, and then get the pitch of decision.
Make it bad without bouncing it away and let Baylor score from third. 1-2. Got him. And he got him with the breaking ball, so the Dodgers continue to sputter, as they have been doing for quite a while, especially with Fernando. And they leave runners at first and third. It's 3-1 Atlanta.
Play ball.
You've got such style, such flair. Do you really believe you've got a prayer?
You'll catch it all on Kodak Color VR400, one of Kodak's fastest color print films ever. You can't miss, almost.
Oh, you're having so much fun, but you never scored a run. That's why the other guys just won.
Kodak, because time goes by.
Company picnic wasn't much. Two bags of chips and a six-pack. But things changed, because we give our customers a good job for a good price. Call it good business, like this Meisterbrau. Sure, I can pick any beer now, but Meisterbrau tastes every bit as good as Budweiser, and it doesn't cost as much, so there's no contest. Hey, any of you overpaid, underworked people want a beer?
Meisterbrau tastes as good as Budweiser at a better price.
Tomorrow live, the 1984 French Open Championship. Ivan Lendl of Czechoslovakia after his first Grand Slam title against John McEnroe. Will he become the first American man to win the French in almost 30 years? Lendl McEnroe for the French Open title, 9 a.m. live in the East, 8 in the West and Central time zones. Right here on NBC.
And for the viewers in Los Angeles, a special time, 10:30 a.m. right here on NBC Sports. Glenn Hubbard, Brad Komensk, and Bruce Benedict. We move into the sixth inning. Braves 3, Dodgers 1. Screwball is pulled to Guerrero. Oh, my. Short hops. One hand throws him out. Hello.
Guerrero makes a good play. Let's take a look at that curveball. It looked like that Mahler threw to Marshall. It looked like a mistake that he got away with. It's up there. I mean, a nice pitch. Look at that.
Ooh.
Yeah, he had a nice pitch. He just got away with it. That's the play that Guerrero just made on Hubbard.
So here's Brad Komensk, the right fielder, who flied to center and struck out. Brad 0 for 2. We were talking about anniversaries on this particular day, baseball anniversaries. There's one other that's important, outside ball two, on this date, June the 9th, 1963. The first Sunday night game in Major League history. It took place in Houston before the dome was built, and the heat was virtually intolerable at old Colt Stadium. Fastball strike, 2-1. In fact, I remember the Dodgers played a doubleheader there one Sunday afternoon, and Drysdale and Koufax pitched, and they each lost 15 pounds. More water, grant you, but still, imagine the exertion. Fouled away. 2-2.
It's funny what you remember when you mentioned different things. You mentioned Colt. I remember Richie Ashburn's great quote, because they had all the bugs that was a problem,
too. Oh, yeah,
too.
And how?
He said the ladies didn't wear perfume. They wore insect repellent.
2-2. Which brings to mind and to memory the unforgettable Judge Roy Hoffeins, whose dream was to come true, the Astrodome in Houston. Fernando working on Brad Komensk, 3-2, one out in the sixth, 3-1 Atlanta. Now back, the battle continues.
I just saw a quote the other day about that dome. They said that's the eighth wonder in the world. The rent's got to be the ninth. What a blast.
Full count of Brad Komensk. We'll have our MVP award, of course, at the end of the game. It's premature. The top of the sixth, one away. Fastball lifted back or first down the line. A trio of Dodgers, and it's R.J. Reynolds. That's the Reynolds wrap. And with two out, it'll be Bruce Benedict.
Bruce Benedict.
Let's pause briefly, shall we, for station identification. All together. This is the NBC.
This is KMOL TV, Channel 4, San Antonio.
Here's Bruce, fly to center, struck out, 0 for 2. Benedict has to be in a little bit of a daze after what's happened to him. I mean, he was an all-star catcher, the number one catcher. And out of the woods comes Alex Trevino. There's a looper, and a Landro on a bounce. It's got to be a shock. You think you're a permanent fixture back there.
I asked about that, and they think Benedict will be doing a lot of catching. They have two pretty good catchers, and Trevino is playing because he's throwing the ball very well. He's been throwing well all year, and he's hot with the bat, and that makes the difference. And what Benedict has been doing today is what's going to get you back in the lineup, handle your pitchers, and get a couple base hits.
There is a trend, however, and it could give Bruce a moment's pause at least with Mahler up there. And it's a comebacker that goes right through Fernando's legs. And stopping at second is Benedict. Fernando is an excellent fielding pitcher, but not that time. Right through his legs.
Shortstop, Rafael Ramirez.
Ball didn't appear to be hit that hard, but you're not that far away from him. It goes right back up the middle, right through the wicket, and Fernando got the glove down just a bit late.
And now he's facing someone who has just become public enemy number one, Rafael Ramirez. He is 8 for 13 in the series. He hit, as we mentioned, over 370 against the Dodgers last year. And he's now batting 297, 2 for 3 today with a single and a double. 4-1. The trends for Benedict we're talking about. In 1981, Benedict led National League catchers in assists. In 82, he led them in fielding percentage. And then last year, he threw out only 23% of opposition runners, and he's having a bad time this year. That might have been one reason why Joe Torre, who had Trevino with the New York Mets, filed it away and said, I need myself another catcher. 2-0 the count to Ramirez with Benedict at second and Mahler at first. 3-1 Atlanta, each side with seven hits, but the Braves are hitting in sync. Fastball, and he's behind to him, 3-0. Deck, Randy Johnson.
Would you let him hit?
No, because he doesn't have any power.
3-0, but he's hitting him well. I'd turn him loose.
Would you?
Yep.
Okay.
We'll see what happens.
Single, fly to right, double a left. He did say he figured he was going to hit 10 home runs this year. 3-0. Three and one.
You were right. I'm going home.
Well, no, would you? But he doesn't have any home runs, so why bother? If he had a few, he can get you three in a hurry. But now 3-1's another story. And we watch the runners, too, because Benedict does not have any running speed. And you have two out. The runners hold. And the pitch is hit down the right field line. But RJ picked it off to the line and makes it and drops it. Ooh. He was there and dropped it.
It looked like he made the last five steps on his heels. I don't know. You'd have to watch the replay, but he looked like he had that thing zeroed in. Let's see if it jarred loose. Right there. See him on his heels? A lot of times when you land on your heels like that, it just kind of has your head bobbling. They want you to run on your toes. I mean, it hit him right smack dab in the middle of the glove.
Right in the middle.
If there'd have been a bell in there, it'd sound like Lionel Hampton.
Well, they haven't. They are now saying no error. They feel that he had to come too far.
Oh, how charitable.
So we'll see what Ramirez does with a big break. 3-2, the runners go, and the fastball line to right, right at RJ. That's like Yogi Berra dropping the foul ball and Allie Reynolds no-hitter,
right,
and immediately getting another one and catching it. So two left, and at the end of 5.5, Braves 3, Dodgers 1.
Too bad everyone isn't a sort of perfect sleeper. He's the one who's awake. That's because he slept great on a sort of perfect sleeper mattress. You see, only Serta has the total suspension system, a new dimension of total support and comfort. So make a healthy investment in yourself.
Son, let's talk about your future.
Future?
Be a sort of perfect sleeper.
I started delivering beer in 1893. At the time, Milwaukee was teaching America how to really brew a quality beer. Well, guess what? Times haven't changed all that much.
This is today's Milwaukee's best, with a smooth old-time taste, old-time quality, and a real fair old-time price. Milwaukee's best. It's one of the best deals I've seen around here since 1893.
Introducing Milwaukee's best. Old-time quality at an old-time price.
Say goodbye to America's favorite can of motor oil. That Quaker State quality America has trusted for over 70 years now comes exclusively in this unique, easy-to-pour plastic bottle, made to cost you nothing extra.
So long, spouts.
See you, dirty hands. Goodbye, oily rags.
No more leaky cans.
Get Quaker State's pen-grade protection and no mess. Easy to open, pour, and reseal. Today, you need an oil this good in a package this good.
Last night, Philadelphia got well in a hurry. They beat Pittsburgh a doubleheader while the Cubs lost, so they start the day in a flat-footed tie. The Mets won, so they're one back, and the Cardinals, who are playing good ball, have won four straight. They're just one back in the East. In the West, the Dodgers, by beating Atlanta, got it to within 2.5. Detroit got some breathing room again because they beat Baltimore. Toronto lost, so Detroit leads Toronto by 5.5, Baltimore by 10. The Angels were rained out and the White Sox won, so California leading Chicago by 1, and Kansas City's alive and well. They're just 1.5 back at the start of the day. And in the bottom of the sixth inning, 3-1 Atlanta. The Dodgers sputtering. They have 7 hits, but they have only one run to show for it. They had 2 on and nobody out in the second, and Guerrero hit into a double play. Here's Landreau. They had first and second, and Marshall grounded out in the third. They had first and third in the fifth, and Marshall struck out. So the Dodgers have been a bit wasteful. And Mahler fighting his way out of the clinches, and he's leading 3-1. High fly ball into right field. Back goes Kominch to the track, to the wall. It's gone. Last night now has 4, 18 RBIs. Take another look.
He gets it all. He knows it's a home run. You know, I guess it's an old habit, Vin, but whenever a fella hits a home run, I look at the catcher and the umpire, they both got their heads down watching to see if he tags home plate.
Hoping against hope that somehow he'll miss it.
Don't give it to him until it is proven so.
So it's Braves 3, Dodgers 2, and here's Guerrero. Fouls away, and Donnie Moore is up again in the Atlanta bullpen. Here comes Joe Torre. Looking at Mahler's numbers, that's only the third home run he's allowed. The fellow who's been killed by home runs for the Braves is a left-hander, Pete Falcone. He's given up a dozen. So Rick Mahler waiting for the manager to approach the mound. And there's Donnie Moore in the pen. Joe Torre has decided he's going to the bullpen. So Rick Mahler is KO'd on the home run by Kenny Landreau, opening up matters in the sixth inning. And it is 3-2 Atlanta.
The elements will come to test your spray paint outside where metal needs great protection. When you choose an ordinary spray paint based on price, you pay the price. When you choose Rust-Oleum spray paint, you choose a paint that fights fading and rust longer than ordinary spray paint. So when the elements come, be ready. When others fail, Rust-Oleum won't.
When I started delivering beer back in 1893, the supermarket was a blacksmith shop. Well, those days are gone. But maybe not entirely.
You see this? Today's Milwaukee's best. It's got a smooth old-time taste.
Old-time quality.
And a real fair old-time price. Milwaukee's best. It's just the kind of deal that his great-great-granddaddy would have loved.
Introducing Milwaukee's best. Old-time quality at an old-time price.
Hey, see this? It's the big Ford F-Series pickup. The world's best-selling pickup. It's big, and it's tough, with plenty of engine choices, too. Yeah, big Ford pickup, the heavyweight champ.
Hey, hold it, Larry. Check out the small-size Ford Ranger. Even though it's smaller, it's tough, too. And Ranger is the most powerful small truck. So, Larry, you don't have to be big to be tough.
You are talking about trucks, of course. Big Ford pickup.
Small Ford Ranger. Both built for tough.
Len Berman in New York, and in Boston, the Red Sox are showing no mercy. Add three more on this Mike Easler three-run homer, so it's now 15-6 Boston as they play the eighth inning. Let's get back to Vin and Joe in Los Angeles.
Well, 15's not bad. That's a little more than halfway to 29 on their anniversary. Meanwhile, a disappointed Rick Mahler, somewhat downcast, came in here with a four-game winning streak, struggled, and comes out, but at least he goes out leading. So he can still win it. And Donnie Moore, no record, will pick up for him. Moore's ERA, a little under 2.5. He'd been around in the majors for parts of 8 previous years. He only had one full year with the Cubs in 1977. Half swing foul. You know, Donnie Moore is a career-long reliever trying to get Guerrero here in the sixth. Moore had been in 174 games prior to this year, and in less than a third of them was he involved in either a win, a loss, or a save. You rarely know he's in there. Fouled away.
The long man in relief is like an interior lineman. You don't know about him unless somebody tells you about him, and you hope when you go in to negotiate a contract that the general manager is astute enough to realize that, and most of them are, because if he goes into the late inning, he's going to be four-serve at Rosian.
0-2. Fouled away. Yeah, that's a great point. Imagine now, in all those games, less than a third of them, does he have a win, a loss, or a save? You don't get your name in the story, and yet you've had to do a pretty good job to be called upon all those times. And as you put it, interior lineman. By the way, the bullpen for Atlanta has been incredible. With 20 saves, they have a string of 20 and a third scoreless innings. 0-2 to Guerrero. Got him. Boy, the Wolves are all over Guerrero, and there's not much he can do. You know he's trying, and down he goes.
Strikeout, he hit the ball hard, and was robbed of a base hit in a double play. He just blew the ball right by him. It's a contrast between Donnie Moore and Mahler, because Mahler is spotting the ball, changing speeds, and you can see Guerrero's reaction. He just doesn't know what to do as he flings the helmet. There's nothing anybody can do. He's got to battle it out himself.
I know the only thing you can do is leave him alone. He was hot, and they gave him a wide berth when he came in the dugout.
And nobody will leave. They'll pretend like he's not even there.
Yeah, he's going to go off by himself and think about it. Well, here's Socia. Slicing foul off third, out of play. I don't know whether, when you sign a contract for that kind of money, whether you are putting more pressure on yourself. But
I think so.
I think so, too, huh?
Sure. You try to give them their money's worth, and they say, just do what you did, and that's why you got the contract. But that's easier said than done.
Well, and he started off on the wrong foot. I mean, after all, he signs a contract, right, for $7 million, and the papers are full of it, and he shows up to spring training late and overweight. So right away, the jury is saying, uh-huh. Talk about a fat cat. 2-2. Might not be true, but you open yourself
that's
open
right
to that.
I tell you, when you're in a deep slump like he's in, brother, you want to get a room on the first floor and electric razors.
I remember Don Newcomb and Roy Campanella used to room together in the days when players roomed together all the time. Down goes Socia. And Nuke and Campy were saying one
Short
year they were incredible. Campy tore up the league hitting, and Nuke got everybody out. He said the phone in our room in the hotels constantly ringing, constantly. The next year, neither one could do anything, right? They said the operators wouldn't even give him a wake-up call. Well, here's Anderson, a bunt single fly to center. 0-1. Good one. Braves 3, Dodgers 2. We're in the bottom of the sixth. Anderson had a severely pulled hamstring. You were badly hurt, weren't you, playing ball?
Oh, yes.
Ground ball to the left. There's Ramirez with that vacuum cleaner glove when he feels like it. And a good tag by Shambliss. So a good play by Rafael.
The Dodgers get one run, one hit, the home run by Landreau. And at the end of six, Braves 3, Dodgers 2. We'll be back. Of course we will. Where are we going? After these messages from your local station.
Live from New York!
We stop this silly sketch for an important announcement.
I don't want to read that. It would only cause unnecessary concern.
It's Saturday night!
Painting was a messy, time-consuming job until I bought a Rotoflow paint sprayer. Now it's faster and easier. There's no thinning, just pour and paint. Overspray and mist aren't problems either, and that means less mess. When I stained the house, I got crisp, clean patterns from a half to 18 inches wide, and the handy ceiling cup makes overhead work a snap. Rotoflow. It'll save you time, and you can forget the mess.
See Rotoflow at... Save on Valvoline at Auto Shack. For true discount prices on all your automotive needs, shop Auto Shack. Available at Dillard's.
Bush. Brewed the natural way for a taste as smooth as its name.
Bush. Head for Bush Beer.
Head for the mountains.
Hot doggy. Ed Sheer Motor Company's got something brand new.
Right, Dad. It's the grand opening of our complete line of beautiful motorhomes by America's premier manufacturers. Sport Coach, Pathfinder, Cross Country, and Midas. Luxurious motorhomes from 20 to 34 feet for the features that you want most.
They even have those newfangled microwave ovens.
Come on out this weekend and get the lowest prices of the year at Ansara Motor Company, the new store next door to the Chevy store.
And ask for my son, Junior.
George McKenzie and the final score.
We're going to the seventh inning with the Braves leading the Dodgers 3-2. And in the seventh, it'll be Randy Johnson, Gerald Perry, and Dale Murphy. Johnson double, singled, and sacrificed. So he's 2-for-2. He has hit in 10 straight. And look at that. When he plays, they win, at least almost all the time. Fastball away. In one-run decisions this year, the Braves have won 9 of 13. The Dodgers have won 14 and lost 9. Braves had a very bad record in one-run games last year. A chopper to Anderson. He's waiting. Now throws and just does get him. Dave was kind of caught in between hops.
He was. That was a much tougher play than it appeared because the ball took the big hop. He had to wait for it, and he had a pretty good runner going down the line, so he had to gun it, which he did.
With one out, here's Gerald Perry coming up. Take another look at him waiting for that hop.
He got something on that throw.
And you got a big enough first baseman at 6'3" in Greg Brock. Here's Perry. Walked twice and struck out. Ball one. 3 runs, 7 hits for Atlanta. 2 runs, 8 hits for the Dodgers. And we're in the seventh. 1 ball, no strikes. Boy, he didn't get cheated. He really had a rip. 1-1.
Boy, he just looks like a hitter. When he stands there, the arms away from the body, the bat is still, and he brings it right from where the bat is. No hitch.
Tried to bunt the fastball and fouled it back. On deck, Dale Murphy. Murph today has grounded out to pick up an RBI, single to knock in another, and was walked intentionally. 1-2 the count, and Gerald Perry. And he bangs one into right center field for a base hit. Landreau over to cut it off, and Perry making Kenny throw with a good turn, and Lasorda eyeballing everything that takes place.
Dale Murphy.
So that's 8 hits for Atlanta. Meanwhile, Joe Torre trying to nurse that one-run lead along. Last year, the Braves had the worst one-run record. They were 10 games under 500 in one-run games. Lasorda's either on the phone to the bullpen or he's found an Italian takeout restaurant nearby.
Dial a prayer.
There he is. There's Murphy. 3 runs, 8 hits for Atlanta. 2 runs, 8 hits for the Dodgers. Perry, who runs well, remember, on the double steal, he was the front man. That was in the third inning. high pop fly, Baylor should take care of it. And boy, look at that. Oh, almost over the shoulder going away, fighting the glare. And only his experience, I think, saved him. Watch this.
He's having trouble right there. Now he'll turn away from it, play it off to the side, and he makes the play. Tell you, I'd look for Mr. Perry to maybe take off here with Chambliss in that batter's box, because Socia will not have a clear view. Chambliss, a big guy, will set up a nice screen. And you wanted Murphy to take a swing, see if he could pop one out of here.
And he goes right away. The pitch is strike. Socia to Anderson. Too late. So Gerald Perry is giving the Dodger battery a bad time, as he did last night and today. Had two stolen bases last night, two more today.
He almost slides so hard that he comes off the bag. He's in there right there, and he has to make sure he stays there.
So Perry is at second with two out. Socia gives one of the oldest signs in baseball, flapping his arms like a bird, telling the infield to knock the ball down. Don't let it go through. I guess that sign's been around as long as the game has been played.
102 years. Fernando threw that ball hard, almost got by Socia as it bounced into the dirt.
Chambliss struck out twice, fly to center, 0 for 3. Fernando has pitched him very, very tough.
I'm surprised the umpires haven't asked him to take that chain off. That's a whole big new rage that the making pitchers stop pitching with the gold medal around them.
1-1. Breaking ball lifted to left center field and deep. Marshall on the dead run at the track and makes the catch. So Fernando got away with a breaking ball that seemed to hang. And now, here's another edition of the seventh inning stretch.
Old Spice presents... The seventh inning stretch, brought to you by Old Spice Aftershave and Cologne. Splash on the feeling. Splash on Old Spice.
Maury Wills couldn't stick it in the bigs until he learned to switch hit. In 1959, Maury was a 26-year-old rookie with the Los Angeles Dodgers. Already a mature hitter, a stinger from either side, and always liable to beat out a bunt. Quick and elastic at shortstop, Wills went on to earn two gold gloves. But Maury's real delight was stealing bases, and he led the league for six consecutive seasons. In 1962, Maury snatched 104 bases and ran away with the Most Valuable Player award. Maury prompted a total of three Dodger championships. And in the 1965 World Series, Wills tied a record with four hits in one game. He arrived late, but lasted 14 years. Maury Wills, always looking to cash a base hit into a run.
All you gotta do is smell the coffee, splash on Old Spice. Now you're moving, isn't it nice? Up and at 'em, don't think twice. Pour out a handful, splash on some spice.
Nobody sends more guys out there than America's favorite, unmistakably masculine Old Spice.
Splash on the feeling, splash on some spice.
And now, to soothe sensitive skin, try Old Spice Conditioning Aftershave.
Appropriately enough, we opened up today saluting Henry Aaron. And it is right and proper to salute the seventh inning honoree, Maury Wills, who provided so many thrills for people right here at Dodger Stadium. Now, Fernando will begin it. He sacrificed and hit the ball hard in the fifth inning when he lined out to left field, but that was against Rick Mahler. Now Donnie Moore is out there. Fernando, not a bad hitter. He has five hits this year, fouled away. When he sacrificed in the third inning, remember, he laid down a good bunt. He has hit two home runs in his career against Steve Mura and Gene Garber of the Braves. And he loves to swing the bat. 0-2. Donnie Moore trying to save this one for the starter, Rick Mahler. Donnie's out of Lubbock, Texas. Began last year at Richmond, and then eventually called upon and became the third most used Braves pitcher. He had seven consecutive outings last year. He didn't allow a run. Originally a product of the Cubs farm system. 0-2. And ironically, his first big league victory came against Atlanta. Can't beat him, join him. Moore is the kind of pitcher that Bob Gibson likes because he goes after him like that. He's always ahead. He's not trying to finesse you. 3-2 Braves, one out. Let's go to New York.
Bottom of the sixth in Baltimore. Bases loaded. John Lowenstein delivers. Ripken scores. Murray scores. It's now 3-0 Orioles as they try to pull within 9 games of the first place Tigers. Let's go back to Dodger Stadium.
Okay, Len, the Birds getting off the ground against Detroit. The Dodgers trying to do something and catch Atlanta. The Braves leading 3-2, and with one out, here's R.J. Reynolds, who is 0-3. 4-1. Remember, Landro homered, and Moore was brought in, and he struck out Guerrero and Socha. Now he strikes out Valenzuela. That's why we said he's a Gibson-type pitcher. He goes right after the hitter. Slicing fly ball to left field, and Gerald Perry is there. Hello. You know where that first started, I think, in Atlanta. Rico Carter, I believe, was the first guy to always catch a fly ball one-handed, and Paul Richards went crazy, and Richards said to Carter, you've got to catch it with two hands. And Carter said, I can't catch it with two hands. He said, you're going to catch it with two. So he tried and dropped it. Said, all right, catch it with one. And then it seemed like everybody in the big leagues caught it with one hand.
I was going to say Leon Daddy Wags Wagner.
Oh, really? He used to do him too?
I used to do that. Vic Power at first base.
Oh, well. Yeah, Tony Bardarone was the first. I mean, he only had one hand.
Well, there's a great theory behind it.
Slicing drive to right center, but Kaminska's there. Two hands. And the Dodgers are done in the seventh inning quickly. So Donnie Moore's retired 6 in a row. And at the end of 7, the Braves, 3 runs, 8 hits. The Dodgers, 2 runs, 8 hits.
Don't do it, dummy.
Today's the day.
Those desktop computers are for PhDs.
I need one. Things are getting out of control.
They're for Einsteins.
I can handle it.
Says who? Wait till the chief sees you fumbling around that keyboard.
Warning. What's going on?
The chief's getting a computer right on his desk.
Is that a fact?
Despite some nagging little doubts, more and more people are ordering IBM computers of their own. Smart people want smart desks.
Okay, okay.
Welcome to Miller Time.
At Miller High Life, time is everything. Beer drinkers come to us because we've been brewing in extra quality for the last 129 years. That's a lot of our time. But it's the reason you spend your time with us when you want the best beer you can find. Miller High Life.
Welcome to Miller Time.
Oh, boy. Got one. I can fly ball going on the ground ball.
Father's Day. Take him out to a ball game.
Baseball fever. Catch it.
The preceding message was furnished by Major League Baseball.
Alex Ramos, the Bronx Bomber. John Collins, the big southpaw from the Windy City. Two middleweight contenders at the crossroads. On NBC Sports World, there is a world of difference.
Boy, there ought to be some thumping in that one, with Collins with 27 knockouts and Ramos with 13. And that's tomorrow at Sports World, a 10-round middleweight bout, 4 p.m. Eastern Time. Glenn Hubbard to start it against Fernando, 4-1. Hubbard, Kaminsk, and Benedict. And if they get to Moore's spot, Joe Torre thinking hitter because Terry Forster is throwing in the Braves' bullpen. Hubbard 0-3, strike, 1-1. Fly to center, popped to short, grounded to third. One and two. You can see why Fernando strikes him out when he twists and turns like that. Pretty impossible pitch to hit. One and two. Fernando has 7 strikeouts. Fastball got him, so he really set him up. And that would be his eighth strikeout. Remember, his high is 15.
Thoroughly confused, Hubbard chases a bad ball, a fastball. He just wants to foul it off and try to stay alive and get the next one. But you can see the pitch way outside the strike zone. That's good pitching. He's ahead of the hitter. Make him hit your pitch and let him battle it off.
Not only does he lead the league in strikeouts now, but of course, remember, Nolan Ryan is on the DL. Dwight Gooden is second, five back, but of course he picks him up in bunches too. 0-1 to commence. I have never seen Valenzuela pitch any better than the night he struck out the 15th Phil. Commenced, flied to center, struck out, flied to right. 0-2.
I tell you, he's been tough today. That runs they got in that first inning. That ball that Randy Johnson hit, I still wonder about it.
Yeah, whether Landro could have caught it. And then there was a balk, and another run came in on a slow ground ball. He now has 9 strikeouts. This is what usually has been happening to him. He gives up a run or two, and really only that's all. The Dodgers just don't score. And somehow he has to make do. And as we mentioned earlier, when he beat the Phils and Carlton 1-0, he drove in the only run. Lasorda visiting with Joe Amalfitano. This telecast presented by authority of Major League Baseball may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form without the express written consent of Major League Baseball. And Bruce Benedict at the plate. One and oh. Benedict flied to center, struck out and singled. Chopper to Guerrero. So it's an easy inning for Fernando, but he's a buck short. The Dodgers will have Brock, Marshall, and Landro, and at the end of 7.5, 3-2, Atlanta.
A little loss of control here could ruin your whole day.
Test pilot Chuck Yeager for AC Delco.
Even on the highway, I stay on top of my car with the new Delco Performer Shock Absorber. Its sealed gas cell eliminates air bubbles and provides a constant cushion in lab tests and on the highway. It's the only shock your car will ever need.
Never wait for trouble. Get the Delco Performer.
Call 800-AC-DELCO for a retailer near you.
Up before the sun, got the Honda ATC, gonna have some fun. Going three-wheeling, it's my lucky day.
Turn the city over to the next shift. The rest of the night is yours.
To Miller time.
Now comes your time for the best beer you can find. Miller High Life.
Bring your thirsty self right here. You've got the time. We've got the beer for what you have in mind. Welcome to Miller time.
Ernie Banks sets the stage for our doubleheader.
We got the set in, sunshine, fresh air, we got the team behind us, so let's play two.
Philadelphia battles the Cubs, or Pittsburgh at Montreal. Then the White Sox take on Oakland, or Baltimore faces the Yankees. The teams are here.
It'll be a great Saturday, a great day for baseball. Joe and I will go to Yankee Stadium and take a look at the world champion Orioles and Yogi's gang, who have really been struggling. The Yankees began the day 18 games back. In the bottom of the eighth inning, Braves 3, Dodgers 2, and Donnie Moore will be facing the heart of the lineup, the numbers 3, 4, and 5 hitters. Steve Bedrosian down in the bullpen now, so things getting to that point where Bedrosian and Forster loosening up. Strike. Bedrosian really shook up early comers to Dodger Stadium, not because of his Atlanta uniform. He was wearing a Boston Celtics shirt. 0-2. There he is. I mean to tell you, the early comers in the ballpark went crazy when they saw it. He's from Massachusetts, and of course the Celts are leading the Lakers 3-2. The sixth game will be played here Sunday, and then if necessary, they'll go back to Boston. But it was quite a sight to see Bedrosian out on the field. 0-2 to Brock. Grounded out and then singled twice. He's 2-for-3. Donnie Moore with 3 strikeouts. He's retired 6 in a row. 1-2. Brock, coming off the disabled list, took his first at-bat since the 5th of May, and he hits a bullet at Ramirez.
He hardly had to move for that one. Looked like it might have knuckled out there. I mean, he hits it, goes with the pitch, and it's right at Ramirez. That double day, I tell you, he knew something about this game to place those players where he placed them.
And Ramirez kind of looked in his glove. He's still shaking his head about that. I think that ball was just starting to take off on him.
Knuckled on him.
So one away, and now Mike Marshall trying to get the Dodgers even. Fastball fouled away. He hadn't gotten many of those, but he tried to jump on that one. His base hit was a single to open up the second inning. That's when the Dodgers had singles by Marshall and Landreau, but with nobody out, Guerrero hit into a double play, and Socia fouled out. 1-1. So fastball in, breaking ball away, familiar pattern. One out in the eighth, 3-2 Atlanta.
And down.
You know, to show you sometimes how it is David and Goliath, the Dodgers played Philadelphia consecutive games. The number 3 hitter for the Dodgers in one game was Bob Baylor. And then the second game was rookie Lemmy Miller, who's back in the minors. The number 3 hitter for the Phils, Mike Schmidt, at some contest. 2-2. In the eighth inning, Braves 3, Dodgers 2. Finale of the series tomorrow. Got him. And he looks like a young hitter who is just trying to carry the ball club, and that's too much of a load.
He's putting pressure on himself, but again, Moore makes the pitch out of the strike zone. He's ahead of the hitter, and if they're going to chase it, they're going to have to chase his pitch, and he couldn't hit that with another 4-foot extension to that bat.
Looked like a change, too, after a big motion in an absolute perfect spot. Well, here's Landreau, single to left, grounded out and homered. Ball one. 1-0 to Kenny. One and one.
He's got something on that fastball. I mean, I know scientists say that the ball doesn't rise and does this and does that. All I know, that ball seemed to bend in the middle.
Donnie Moore trying to save it for the starter, Rick Mahler, and he's doing a dandy of a job. Fastball away. 2-1. Donnie, 30 years old, been playing professionally since 1973. Away, 2-2. Donnie Moore working on Kenny Landreau. Moore is the first cousin of the New York Mets' Hubie Brooks. Just foul off Chambliss' glove, and it stays 2-2. The Braves scored 2 in the first inning. Ramirez singled. Johnson doubled him to third. Fernando balked in Ramirez. Johnson taking third. He walked Perry. And Johnson scored as Murphy grounded out. In the third inning, Johnson singled and Perry walked. And Murphy's single got Johnson home. That accounts for the Braves 3. The Dodgers picked up a run in the third. On 2 singles on a walk, Brock single scored Anderson, who had bunted himself aboard, and then Landreau homered in the sixth, and that's it. So you're up to date. 3-2 Atlanta, two out. 3-2 to Landro in the bottom of the eighth, and on deck, Pedro Guerrero. Foul back. Here's Pedro. Been another tough day for him. Boy, it's a cruel game when you're not going well. I mean to tell you, it's one thing to be a star. 3-2 to Landro. Lifted down the left field line. Perry was shifted to left center, coming over to the line, and Gerald is there. So the Dodgers are running out of innings. Donnie Moore is doing a great job, and at the end of eight, the Atlanta Braves 3 and the Dodgers 2.
You are looking at the most advanced shock absorber that Monroe has ever made. Gasmatic, so advanced that in testing, people preferred the Gasmatic ride 3-1 over conventional shocks.
The difference was dramatic in the control, the stability, and the comfort.
A ride so superior, if Gasmatics don't give you the best ride ever, we'll replace them no charge. Monroe Gasmatic shocks and struts for the best ride ever. Guaranteed.
You're working a charter. Your days belong to somebody else, but your nights are all yours.
To Miller time!
Now comes your time for the best beer you can find, Miller High Life.
Bring your thirsty self right here. You've got the time. We've got the beer for what you have in mind. Welcome to Miller time.
I know what you're thinking. What are we going to get Dad for Father's Day? Well, take it from me. Dad, check out the Sears Hardware Sale. These Craftsman power tools are just $39.99 each. That's half price. Save 50% on this Craftsman 42-piece mechanics tool set, just $39.99. Save $20 on a weed whacker trimmer. And save $100 on this gas grill. Save on lots of other hardware gift ideas, too. Did you get that, Marge?
There's more for your life at Sears.
Sunday, it's Wheels of Death as Kit storms the racetrack to stop a motocross murder. But can Michael stand the pace?
We're slapping!
On Knight Rider Sunday.
You're looking at Jerry Royster, who is going to lead off the inning batting for Donnie Moore. Boy, did Moore do a number on the Dodgers.
He struck out four. He retired the nine men he had to face. And as we mentioned earlier, unless the general manager and the manager mark that down, he gets down in the same category with other famous people like Whistler's father, second in command on the Nina, the Pinto, or the Santa Maria. I mean, he's going to get lost in the shuffle because they got Bedrosian and Forrester down there, but Donnie Moore did a super job.
Boy, he sure did. So Donnie Moore comes in and just shuts the door down after Landro had homered against Mahler to open up the sixth inning. The Dodgers were in the game, and then Moore just said, that's it.
And Guerrero had that real good cut. He had one good swing at Mahler, and that was enough for Torrey to bring in Moore.
Royster, a former Dodger, is the senior member of the Braves. Now that Phil Niekro and Biff Pokoroba are gone, Royster joined Atlanta from Los Angeles in December of 1975, and he can play just about anywhere, second, short, third, and all the outfield positions. Ground ball to Brock. He spots Fernando coming over. One away. To look ahead, and Lasorda will do just that. The Dodgers' do-up are Pedro Guerrero, Mike Socia, and Dave Anderson. And you put quotes around the word do. Lasorda will have to make his decision. If he brings in Bedrosian, Lasorda has Rick Monday, Terry Whitfield, and Franklin Stubbs as left-handed batters available. Strike. Ramirez singled and doubled, flied to right and lined out to right. Remember when R.J. dropped his foul ball and he hit another one right at him. Well, Atlanta's not going to be able to do it because they lost here last night. The most enjoyable West Coast trip since San Diego came in the league was enjoyed by the Philadelphia Phillies, who came to California and won all nine. Oh, good. good off speed. One and two. You can hurt your back on that swing, huh? Look at that.
Until you get a high change, that ball up around the letters, you see it so well. That's why they get cuts like you just saw. You see that ball and you want to take a whack at it. Get that top limb. Watch where this pitch is. It's up his eyes and oh, baby.
He doesn't have a home run yet, and he was thinking about that one. Here's the one and two pitch. Pass ball away. Two and two. Fernando has allowed three runs and eight hits. He has struck out nine. Still two and two. Pitches. It's not really too many, especially when you realize he started off throwing so many. He was like 65 pitches and he was in the third inning. But he's really turned it around when you put it in perspective. Two and two. Hit down the right field line and it's going to be a fair ball, and Ramirez just keeps doing it, and Fan grabs it, so it's a ground rule double. So all Ramirez does is come up with three more hits, two doubles and a single.
I wonder how they talk about him in the meeting.
I was just wondering. I mean, he hit 371 against the Dodgers last year, and he's just absolutely destroyed them in this series.
Fan's about to lose everything, isn't he?
He'll probably lose his seat, too. I'm sure they will take him out of here. They make the announcement asking the crowd not to interfere with the ball in play. All right, you have Ramirez at second with one out. And here's Randy Johnson. Double, single, sacrificed, grounded out. Ground ball wide at third. Boy, that thing was hugging the ground. Guerrero gets him with Ramirez holding. Two down, and Gerald Perry will be coming up. Ramirez is 9 for 15 in this series as he visits with Bob Baylor. They just can't get him out.
With Perry coming up to hit, watch him in the batter's box, how he gets that bat back, arms away from the body, and how he really doesn't move it and brings that bat right from the point that he's got it set. Love to watch him hit.
Ball one.
He's got it cocked, hasn't he?
Mm-mm. Ready to pull the trigger.
Here's a good look at what we're talking about. Now watch that, those arms away from that body.
One ball, no strikes. That missed. Ball two. He came up from the minor leagues as a first baseman, but they're playing him in the outfield. Gerald Perry. He might be, down the road, the heir apparent to Chris Shambliss' job. Of course, Chris has 2.5 years to go on his contract. Fernando doesn't want too much of it, even though Dale Murphy is on deck. Perry with two walks and a single. Murphy has a single in three trips. Two out. Reacting, they are escorting that fan out of the ballpark, the fan who interfered with the ball hit by Ramirez. 3-0, the count to Gerald Perry. Well, he pitched all around him. Not that he wants to look at Murphy, but he just didn't want to give Perry anything good to hit. So here comes Dale. Ramirez at second, Perry at first. Murphy is grounded to third to pick up an RBI. Single to center to get an RBI. Was walked intentionally and popped up. In the Dodger bullpen, Pat Zachary, who pitched so well last night, gets up to throw behind Fernando. The Dodgers will be minus the services of Tom Niedenfuhr for at least another week. At least. And Murphy hits it on the hands. He was jammed, and Marshall is there. No runs, one hit, two left. And we're going to the bottom of the ninth. Guerrero, Socha, and Anderson due up to face Steve Bedrosian.
Most Air Express companies charge extra for delivery to out-of-the-way places. We don't. In fact, Federal Express can get your package to more places overnight than anybody. So if you have something that absolutely positively has to be somewhere, give us a call. Federal Express. Why fool around with anyone else?
This is one of the few computers that has not benefited from AT&T computer technology. Over the years, AT&T innovations have helped other companies' computers become smarter, faster, and easier to use. This is AT&T's newest innovation, AT&T Computers. Business computers specially designed to let people communicate more easily, more reliably. They may just change the way you think about computers.
This is Mr. Goodwrench. Did you know that your GM car's engine uses more air than gasoline? For every sip of gas, it takes 15 gulps of air. That's why a clean air filter helps keep you from wasting power or damaging your engine. So let Mr. Goodwrench check your oil, fuel, and air filters. Chances are you'll save gas and money, too.
It's another of Mr. Goodwrench's good ways
to keep that great GM feeling with genuine GM parts.
If you've never watched soccer, you owe it to yourself to be there for this one on NBC Sports World, Sunday.
Bottom of the ninth inning, 3-2 Atlanta. One change defensively in the outfield. Albert Hall takes over for Gerald Perry in left, and Hall will bat ninth. And Steve Bedrosian, the Bedrock as they call him, he will be in the number three slot. He is not an out, an earned run in his last 19 innings. The only earned runs he has given up this year in 33 innings are home runs by Jose Cruz and Greg Nettles. That's all.
And he's another one of those pitchers who comes at you. He's not going to finesse you. He's going to come right to you.
Earned run average of half a run. So Steve Bedrosian will go up against Guerrero, Socia, and we'll see about Anderson. Guerrero has hit into a double play, grounded out, and struck out. Fastball. Boy, this is reducing the game to its fundamentals. Guerrero has gone 0-for-3 or worse 18 times this year, so he's had a bad case of the offers. Bedrosian saved 19 games last year while winning 9. Half swing. They're going to check. Swing, says Harry Wendelstedt. So as it always is for a hitter in a slump, every time you look up, he's 0-2.
Here's that half swing. Good call. He but split his back.
You know, Bedrosian is so good. Torrey's biggest challenge, I think, is to make sure he doesn't overuse him. Remember, he slumped badly in the second half of last year. In each of the last two seasons, he's been the only National League pitcher to get more than 100 strikeouts coming out of the bullpen. And coming into today, he's not blown a save this year. So Torrey has a big responsibility handling this guy, and he knows it. Fouled away, 1-2.
He just plays good old country hardball, and as the late and great Diz used to always say, he can fire.
Well, Torrey used Bedrosian in 70 games last year. He throws so hard, expends so much energy.
That's very dangerous and a very bush league thing to do. The foul ball went in the stands, and as you can see, they threw it back and cheering because it almost got Guerrero.
Some kid thinks he's a big man. Half swing on that hard slider, and down goes Guerrero. So he's really pressing. So Torrey sees Bedrosian, and he watches Guerrero chase it. Friends, the executive producer of NBC Sports, Michael Weissman, the coordinating producer for NBC Baseball, Harry Coyle, the telecast of today's game of the week, produced by George Finkel, directed by John Gonzalez, pregame produced by Les Dennis, pregame directed by Mary Buda, technical directors Ray Figelski and Salvatore Nagita, feature producer Antoinette Macchiaverna, associate directors Ray Benassi and J.D. Hansen. And with one out, Mike Socia facing Bedrosian. Bedrosian's been clocked at 95 miles an hour, and to substantiate that, he has 10 strikeouts in his last six innings. Last year, 120 innings, and Torrey saw him strike out 114. 0-2. On the fists, fouled away. It's a good challenge here. Meanwhile, Lasorda, as he has been doing for the last month, anguishing over the lack of runs. He'll go to a pinch hitter for Dave Anderson. Terry Whitfield is out on deck as he and Monty Basgold look at what's left. There's Terry. 0-2 to Socia. Line drive into right field, base hit. So we're saying it's a good battle because you have a strikeout pitcher against a contact hitter, and at least in this instance, the contact hitter won it. Now, there'll be a runner for Socia, of course. Torrey was unhappy about that. You could read his lips. One word, you could grow flowers with it.
Well, he gave him that fastball low and inside. There's no big secret that Socia is a low fastball hitter, and as you look, Sachs is the base runner.
Now, Sachs running for Socia, representing the tying run in the ninth inning. I think that's really more why Torrey was upset. Not just the base hit, but that Sachs could now get on the base pad. Although Steve has not been a good base stealer at all. He's only break even, and that's not good enough. Major League Baseball Game of the Week has been brought to you by Miller High Life, the best beer for the best time of the day. Welcome to Miller Time. By Quaker State, new and old cars, small and big cars, staying on the road with Quaker State. By Federal Express, why fool around with anyone else? And by Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? Well, here's Whitfield, and there's Sachs. Of the ninth, Braves 3, Dodgers 2, one out. Foul back, 0-1. Torrey trying to keep his club a comfortable 3.5 in front. If the Dodgers win, they would trail by 1.5. Watching Sachs. Sachs, as you can see, break even. 12-12, that's not very good. In fact, I think most baseball people figure you got to be successful, what, 75% of the time? Three out of four?
At least.
Sure. 0-2. Is Rick Monday to bat for Fernando. So Sachs represents a tying run. One out in the ninth. Braves 3, Dodgers 2. It's been Mahler who can win it. Then Donnie Moore, and now Steve Bedrosian.
He keeps throwing over there, but he's not putting a good move on Steve Sachs, the base runner. He's just kind of letting him know and giving him a good look.
Worked him away, one ball and two strikes.
I never did like that. If you're not going to put the good move on him, then concentrate on the hitter and just hold the ball. But when you just lob the ball over there, it doesn't do anybody any good.
1-2 to Whitfield. On the fists, a little blooper back a third down the line. Fair ball. Going to third is Sachs. Whitfield goes to second. Oh, were they lucky on that one? Way Terry Forster in the bullpen if he makes that switch. The Dodgers very fortunate. Whitfield is jammed and hits a little flare that just hit the foul line.